We now continue with the House Joint Subcommittee hearing of federal actions at Waco, Texas in the spring of 1993. Republican Congressman Bill Zelif of New Hampshire and Bill McCollum of Florida co-chair the Joint Subcommittee. This portion runs 2 hours.
These joint hearings of the two subcommittees on Waco will come to order. When we recessed, it was the time for Ms. Slaughter to have her 5 minutes, and I give you the 5 minutes that you now have, Ms. Slaughter.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I want to say for the record that I have learned something new at these hearings, and it's been reinforced over and over that until the new administration came in under Secretary Benson, you've made an enormous amount of changes in the way the ATF will work and the reporting system that it's going to have, and I thank you for it. I think we'll all be better for it. Numbers of things that we've heard have been troubling, and one thing that I want to say is I don't need to be reinforced in my admiration for law enforcement. As I said the other day, it still amazes me that people will go, no matter how that thing was planned or whether it was a botch or not, those men were willing to walk up to that door and get killed. Robert Rodriguez's pain was apparent to me sitting here in this chair. And as far as Ms. Sparks was concerned, I spent a good deal of time talking with her. My recollection of her testimony was that she had been asked by the FBI, I believe, to be prepared to go in and have clothing for children in case the use of CS gas. That's the only comment I recall that she had with any of the authorities. And that they told her not even to worry about it. And indeed, the weekend of the raid, she was away. She was out of town, she said. And when she saw the ladders go up against the house, she thought the children would be killed. She and I discussed at some length, Mr. Corey. She seemed to have much more faith in him than I did, that he would go to jail quietly and then his followers would just give up. I didn't think that followed any of his preachings. And she had said she had only had three contacts, I believe, with him on the compound. But one of the things that I do want to talk about, the new regulations, I think that's terribly important. I hope I'm not stretching it to say the reason those people died and the others were shot because it was tipped off. And it was tipped off because a television man told a postman. And the television man was told by a woman who worked for the ambulance company that the ATF had hired three ambulances from. And then the district director, Mr. Royster, I believe his name was, had given directions to his PR person that he wanted a single person notified that something wonderful was going to happen or might happen, and this was to be done on Friday evening to notify that he wanted this one person called when it happened. And it does make me question whether or not Mr. Royster, and you may be able to answer this for me, Mr. Royster had talked it over with the man and said, you know, something really big is going to happen in Waco, and when it does, I'll tell you first. And another point that keeps sticking in my mind here is the newspaper articles. Everybody was afraid of what was going to come out in those articles. And it makes me question again, had somebody talked to the reporters that what was going to be going on? So whatever you do to change those regulations and what happened, it seems to me, Mr. McGaugh, one of the most important things that you can do is get some control over what I think I would call loose lips. That I'm surprised that your regional director thought that one of the most important things he was doing on Friday was making sure that the proper person would be notified at a television station. Would you give me your views on what you've done to change what to me, and do you agree with me that the absolute fact is that those people were killed because that raid was tipped, and it was tipped because people talked?
And if it wasn't tipped in the way it was, it should have been tipped in 15 or 20 other ways.
Too much talk.
This organization, ATF, one of the first things I realized that they really never did not pay much attention to operational security. And they didn't think about it. It's not that they didn't want to do it. They didn't think about operational security. So we have now a person on assignment from an organization that does very well in operational security. And they're going to spend 6 months with us. I have a new person that I've just assigned to that, and it'll be that person's full-time responsibilities to to oversee operational security for this entire bureau. One of the first things we have to do, and we're in the process of doing now, is sensitize the individuals, cause the individuals to think about it, from what piece of paper they throw in the wastebasket as opposed to the burn bag, and what they say to who, and even in a restaurant or other places, about operational security. And only as it applies to ATF. We're not getting into any other business in terms of operational security.
And in the case of Mr. Rodriguez, it wasn't clear to me, and maybe you can answer this as well. He was going to be sent into the compound on Saturday and Sunday. What method of escape was he to have on Sunday to raid happen?
That's probably the most, one of the most frightening aspects of the review. Mr. Rodriguez was sent in on Saturday and again on Sunday, despite his being worried about the unnecessary attention that would draw to him, and despite his being concerned about his safety. Each time he went into the compound, he went in at risk of serious bodily injury or death to himself. So there was really no plan for him except, as he was, as he stated, and it's reported in our review, what he thought about was jumping out of the window and then just running for his life when David Koresh first came back into the room.
That's dreadful. Do you have any reason to believe, Mr. Noble, from Mrs. Sparks, is there any difference in what I had said, that her conversation was really with the FBI and not with ATF at all?
I don't have a specific recollection, so I would defer to you, ma'am.
Thank you very much. I see my time is just about up. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you, Ms. Slaughter. Next, Mr. Micah, you're given 5 minutes.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Mr. Noble, welcome. You're the one that produced this document, I guess. And
I will take responsibility for whatever is wrong in it, but I will give credit for whatever is right to the people sitting behind me.
What's interesting on page 7 is the overview, and it says, of course, I said this before, but the investigation found disturbing evidence of flawed decision-making, inadequate intelligence gathering, miscommunication, supervisory failures, and deliberately misleading post-raid statements about the raid and the raid plan by certain ATF supervisors. Do you concur with that conclusion?
I do, sir.
And Mr. Noble, you agreed with those accusations just now, but you said earlier that you didn't participate in the rehire, directly involved in the settlement process for rehiring Mr. Sarabin and Mr. Waninsky. Is that correct?
That's correct. The role I played was to make sure that whatever decision was made with regard to Mr. Hanowski and Mr. Sarabin was consistent with...
And you also said
May I finish, please, sir?
I don't have much time, but you also, just a clarification, you also said you never acted as a negotiator and spoke primarily to staff, or only to staff, I think were the words, and you never called anyone outside to discuss the settlement negotiations, is that correct?
That is not the way I recall what I said, sir.
Well, you again said that this is the basis on which these people were fired.
And what is the basis, sir?
Your report and what I read.
I never said that. I never said that, sir.
So what was the basis on which they were fired, Mr. Sarabin?
This report is following, and this is what this report was. On page 182. On page 182 are the concerns that this report articulated,
but
which I would like permission to finish, please, sir.
No, sir.
If you don't want me to answer questions, that's
fine. Your reference, and I'll look that up, and the other members can, but I've got some other questions that I need to get into. I understand that you said that you did not directly participate in the negotiations to rehire Sarabin and Waninsky.
The negotiations?
Yes, the rehiring. Ask you those questions.
The hiring of Mr. Sarabin and Mr.
Rehiring, Hanowski. Rehiring.
Yes, sir. Thank you.
Is that correct? You did not?
I'm trying to answer the question, and each time I try, I'm interrupted.
Did you, as a negotiator in the rehiring settlement with Mr. Winocki and Mr. Serapin.
Mr. Hanowski and Mr. Serapin had lawyers who consulted and negotiated with lawyers from the Treasury Department's General Counsel's Office assigned to ATF.
And you did not participate in the negotiations?
The negotiations were between the lawyers, that's correct.
Well, I received a letter from the sister of Mr. Serapin, who said that, in fact, I talked to Mr. Noble on November 8th. He discussed the possibility of an MSPB settlement. We had a second conversation. During the second conversation, he discussed MSPB settlement. During this conversation, he said I could tell Chuck and his attorney about the conversation. I did so. It is my understanding that Chuck then told Mr. Gardner, his attorney, who immediately contacted Mr. Lopez, the Treasury attorney. Were you negotiating with the sister of Mr. Serapin on the settlement?
Sir, Mr. Serapin's sister called me because a retired ATF agent called her and said that I sounded like a reasonable person to speak to after the agent had left
did
a message
you,
saying...
You did speak with her on three occasions, sir? Sir, did you speak with her on three occasions, yes or no?
You need to allow the witness to answer, Mr. Mike. If you complete his first answer, then you can ask him the second one, and I'll allow both answers. But he has not finished his first answer. I think that's the problem. Mr. Noble, would you please finish?
Thank you. I spoke with Chuck Serapin's sister.
On how many occasions?
Two or three occasions. I did not know, and am surprised to find out that Chuck Serapin's sister was his negotiator. I thought he had hired counsel.
So you were negotiating with his sister on the terms of the settlement and the rehiring?
Sir, that is a mischaracterization of what I said.
Mr. Noble, did Mr. Hartnett come to you at any time after Mr. Winocki and Mr. Serapin had been fired and say that it was his view that these agents were not rehired, their truthful story and the fact that it had been covered up, their truthful story would eventually come out?
Mr. Hartnett never made any statement like that to me, nor have I heard Mr. Serapin or Mr. Hanowski say anything during these hearings or in any MSB hearing or any other context that suggests that anything in this report is untrue, that there is anything to cover up, that there's anything more they have to add. You've had them testify. What have they said that's incorrect about this report?
Mr. Noble, you testified earlier when questioned by Mr. Chabot, my colleague here, that no one in Washington was told that the element of surprise was compromised on the morning of the raid. I'd like the clerk to distribute...
That is not what I said,
document,
sir. That is not what I said. What I said was I was certain that no one in Maine Treasury had been made aware of it.
Well, when
I had no information with regard
to
anyone in ATF had been made aware of it.
All right, in document 21, if you'll look at it, sir, when I read this, it sounds to me like someone in Washington did know, and that Mr. Kavanaugh, who could abort the raid, was on the phone with him. Why didn't Mr. Vita call off the raid, and why didn't Mr. Kavanaugh call off the raid?
I have not heard any information from any witness here at any other time saying that there was someone in Washington who was notified of that raid and who could have called it off, who didn't call it off. This
Mr.
is news to me.
Noble, why isn't this phone call that I've presented the document with presented some information about that in your report?
Sir, nothing you said in the questioning suggests to me that the report should have been changed in any way. Thank you.
Mr. Micah, your time is up. Ms. Jackson Lee, I believe your time is available, and you're recognized for 5 minutes.
Mr. Chairman, thank you very much, and I, for fear of being redundant, I will offer to acknowledge, as I have made a commitment to do, that lives were lost, and this was a tragedy, and I have not heard any response, Mr. Noble, from you to suggest you did not think that this was, in fact, a tragedy, an extreme loss of life.
Very unfortunate, and saddens me to this day.
Let me, if I might, just pursue a line of questioning with you. One, to acknowledge your indignation for a variety of things that may have been said or you may have read. But if I can have a yes or no, and you partly answered it, it is not an indignation or a lack of respect for the loss of lives, whether they be ATF, and you've already made that clear, but the Branch Davidians. Is that my understanding?
Yes.
I also note that during this period of time, you've received several promotions, or at least one, where you're now Undersecretary for Enforcement. In the report that you so noted and allowed us to see the numbers of individuals involved, there was seemingly a suggestion, and maybe even a statement on the record, about cover-up. Was your introduction of these individuals to inform us of the wide number of persons who were part of this report?
That's correct.
And these persons, were all of them under your jurisdiction, or at least in a position to be, if you will, subjugated by you and told what to do? Or were they allowed to fully investigate and to come up with independent assumptions and conclusions, or were you actively involved in their determinations?
They were permitted to investigate this matter thoroughly and comprehensively, which is what they did.
It also has been noted in the record, and I'd like to have a clarification or at least an explanation by you, that at least even though there was not a coordinated coordination in effect, there was a point where you did say hold up, and that was the day before your dinner, your at least either the day of or the day before your dinner phone call that you got. But there was a point, I believe, where you asked some questions about whether we, and this was in the midst of the Trade Center tragedy as well. Is that my understanding?
That's correct.
You actually voice some concerns? Can you tell me your words, please? If you can recollect them to the best of your recollection.
I have a clear recollection of telling John Simpson that I wasn't the acting Assistant Secretary for Enforcement, but if I were the acting Assistant Secretary for Enforcement, I would not let the raid proceed based on a limited amount of information that he had before him.
And you likewise had a limited amount of information?
That's correct.
And this was about the first, this period of time was about the first time it had come to your attention?
This was the first time it had come to my attention in the day, February 26, 1993, late afternoon, early evening.
And did you subsequently learn that, I assume you came on board sometime month of January or February to this present department?
I worked as a consultant Wednesday afternoons through Friday afternoons from January 25th through April 29th, I believe.
In the final conclusion of either reviewing, did you come to understand that this Waco investigation had in fact preceded January 1993 and in fact was going on during the previous administration?
During our investigation, we learned that it was begun in June 20th, 1992, I believe.
So when this call came in during your dinner, you had still had reservations, but what then was the reinforcement, or at least I shouldn't say reinforcement, the data that you got that caused you to make the remarks that you did? And I don't want to put words in your mouth as to what you said.
The director of ATF, a person whom I knew had occupied that position for 10 or 11 years, had personally investigated the matter, had personally been in contact with whomever, either the associate director for law enforcement or the field commanders in Waco, and had gotten assurances that they were sending an undercover agent into the compound, and if anything looked unusual, if Koresh learned about the raid or anything looked unusual at all, that they were not going to go forward with the raid, and he had made that clear to them.
So you heard that there was a backup of not going forward from the person who should be in charge, and I assume those under him. You heard the signal or the words, if Koresh was notified or had knowledge of, would not go forward. If there was any sign of publicity or any element that would remove the surprise or the secrecy or whatever, would not go forward. Is that what you heard?
That's correct. If Koresh acted suspiciously or altered the plan that was the basis for the 10 o'clock in the morning raid, that it would be called off.
And most of all, did you hear that it would be a setting where the women and children would be separated, and let me not put words in your mouth so you can correct me if I'm not recounting it correctly, that the guns would be locked up and that Koresh would be separated or the men would be separated? Did you hear that as well?
That's correct.
You have had a very diverse background. I understand you were a law professor for a period of time.
I hope one day to become a law professor again.
It's an excellent profession. I have a spouse that does that quite well. What did you teach?
Evidence, federal criminal law, and lawyering.
While you were in that setting, would it have been your style to teach incorrect practice?
I hope not.
And so, even though you are not at the cutting edge of the decision, certainly as now the new Undersecretary for Enforcement in your previous position, would you have been concerned about any sort of indicia in the search warrant that would have made it a search warrant that would have failed in court? Would you have been concerned about that?
Absolutely.
And you have the experience then, based upon your teaching credentials, to at least be noted about the failings of any search warrant that would not have made muster in court.
And I was a line prosecutor for some years.
Thank you very much.
Has expired. Mr. Schiff, you're recognized for 5 minutes.
Chairman. Mr. Noble, can I say first that, with respect, contrary to your opening statement, the issue of the military has not been taken off of the table.
Thank you, sir.
I just want to say, I believe that the Posse Comitatus Act may not have been violated, but I think military policy is very seriously violated. Second of all, you said here that the if you were, and I want to misquote you, certainly. I believe you said, if I were Assistant Secretary for Enforcement of the Treasury Department, I knew enough to have called off the raid. Did I hear that correctly?
Very close. I believe I said that.
Close enough for this purpose?
I believe I said that if I were the acting Assistant Secretary for Enforcement, which was the person whom I was advising, I would not have let the raid go forward.
Well, who was the acting Assistant Secretary?
John Simpson.
Pardon?
John Simpson.
All right. And he had the authority to call off the raid?
We believed and acted as though he had the authority to call off the raid.
And he did not do so?
He called off the raid on the evening of February 26th. He told Steve Higgins that in light of the information that he had available before him and certain concerns that were raised, that Steve Higgins was not authorized to proceed with the raid.
But the raid did happen anyway.
Steve Higgins called him back on Friday evening and again on Saturday. The concerns that John Simpson had and the concerns that I had were addressed, and therefore the stoppage, if you will, was lifted.
Right. But the authority to say it can't go back on still was with the Treasury Department, is that right?
We acted as though we had the authority to order Steve Higgins not to permit a raid to go forward, and we acted upon that authority on February 26, 1993.
By ordering him not to go forward?
By directing that in the evening, when John Simpson called Steve Higgins, that based on the concerns that John Simpson had, he would not authorize the raid to proceed.
So I'm just making the point that the Treasury Department could say no, and did say no, at least at one point. I wrote down a part of a quote you said, Mr. Noble. I believe it was, if the Treasury Department directive had been followed, and I don't have the exact words after that, but the implication was the tragedy would not have occurred. Am I pretty close on that?
I believe I said that if the assurances that Director Higgins gave to John Simpson, that the people near Waco or at Waco were told that if anything didn't look right, if Koresh was not acting as previously planned, that the raid would not go forward. That's correct.
So you're saying that there was a violation of the directives from the Treasury Department. And I'd like to ask...
I'm saying that the assurances that Steve Higgins gave were not followed, and that was a tragic mistake that led to the loss of lives.
Are any of these assurances in writing? I mean, is there any paper trail here that we can go back to that you found in putting together the report that we can trace back and forth as to what was said back and forth?
You have the memoranda of interview of Steve Higgins, John Simpson, Michael Langan, Ron Noble.
Any written memoranda?
They've testified under oath before you. You have this memoranda of interview of Mr. Hanasky and Mr. Serafin.
More specific, if I could interrupt for this purpose, were there any written memoranda that went back and forth contemporaneously with these conversations?
These were phone conversations.
Did I also understand that you expressed some, you learned about the FBI plan. This is at the other end of this situation. In April, after the Justice Department and the FBI had taken over the matter, that you learned about their plan to try to go into the compound with tear gas and so forth and end the siege. Did you learn about that before it occurred? Did you learn about the intent of the FBI, now that the Justice Department had taken over this situation, to try to end the siege by moving into the compound?
Before April 19th.
Before April 19th?
Yes, sir.
Did I understand that you felt certain apprehensions about that plan? Do you feel that it posed any specific problems, or were you concerned about it?
I was concerned about it. The FBI had stated to me what the plan was very generally, what the risks were, and that the Attorney General was going to get some independent input and then make a decision.
Well, did you have some concerns, I'm sorry, about what you were being told from the FBI?
The concerns, as I recall, originated with the FBI, that they understood, or at least communicated to me, therefore I assume they understood, that there were risks associated with the plan, but they felt that in light of the circumstances, and all of which they didn't go into, this would be the appropriate thing to do, and that's what they'd recommended to the Attorney General, and she was going to get independent input of some sort.
Well, Mr. Altman, as you know, wrote a memorandum to the Secretary of the Treasury expressing reservations about this plan. Did you have similar reservations?
It's possible that I saw the memo you're referring to either yesterday or the day before, and I guess what Roger Altman did was communicate to Secretary Benson some of what I told him.
Did you have concerns similar to Mr. Altman?
The concerns originated with the FBI, the concerns and the plan, and I say plan in quotes because it wasn't given in any detail, were communicated to me and I communicated them to Deputy Secretary Altman.
I'm going to ask one more time, did you have any concerns and reservations about the plan as it was explained to you by the FBI? That's a yes or a no.
I've tried to answer it straightforwardly, sir. The concerns I had were the concerns that the FBI had, the concerns that I believe anyone who would think about this would have. Yes.
All right. Now, once you had those concerns, as you heard the plan, you being at the rank you were in the Treasury Department, did you go to anyone, either in the Treasury Department or the Justice Department, to express those concerns?
Concerns that they already knew about?
Well, how do you know they already knew about it?
Because they told me.
No, that's the FBI. How do you know the Attorney
FBI General? Is in the Justice Department.
Yes, but how do you know the Attorney General knew about those concerns?
Listen, I operate one way. I assume that career civil servants, career law enforcement officers, people I've worked with, are honest and are going to report things to their boss comprehensively. I don't assume people who tell me things are not going to represent them accurately to their bosses.
Of course, your
report. Your time is up, Mr. Schiff.
Of course, your report charges career law enforcement officers with lying.
That's right. When 61 people say that a Mr. Hanowski, Mr. Serafin pointed the finger at a rank and file agent, yes, that's something we act on.
Mr. Brewster, you're now recognized for 5 minutes.
Thank you, Chairman. Take a little different tack in some of the questions. It's my understanding from some discussions I've had that the Texas Rangers felt they were not treated well at all during the siege time at Waco. Are you aware of that feeling?
Sir, I say this with all due respect to the question. I very much would like to leave this hearing not saying anything bad about any law enforcement component unless necessary. I know, having been with the FBI's hostage rescue team, that when they come into an operation, they take over. And I've been with other law enforcement officers when that happens, and it is not something that makes law enforcement officers who believe they're able happy. That's just the way it is.
Was that a yes?
Yes.
Okay. Along that same line, it was my understanding that Koresh at one point asked to negotiate with the Rangers, and they at one point asked to negotiate with him. Is that correct? And if we could make it shorter, I don't have a lot of time.
Okay, this is going to be fast. I saw it on TV, yes.
I'm sorry?
I saw the Texas Rangers interviewed on TV where they said that, so that's the source of my information.
Okay, I haven't seen that. Mr. McGaw, I'm certainly impressed with the discussion you and I have had previously and also with your discussions of the many things that went wrong here and how you feel that you're making progress in keeping it from happening again that way. Also, I think you've been very straight up in talking about the fact that the tactical intelligence was not good, that you've changed the press structure, that you made many changes in ATF. Along that same line, and I'm just asking a rhetorical question, why would we not be better served for ATF to be part of FBI and FBI do the intelligence part, ATF do the firearms part?
My personal and professional view here, sir, is that if you give firearms to the FBI, firearms take you into every jurisdiction. And once you're into that jurisdiction, you can work it if you come into it through a and what you would be doing is making almost a federal police force. There would be almost nothing they couldn't reach through those firearms in these jurisdictions. I believe that that it would not be the proper thing to do. I think you need the checks and balances like we have now. And Director Free and I and Mr. Constantine, all of, we confer all the time. But I think you need the checks and balances. The other reason is that they've tried to tear this organization apart, as I studied since I've been over here, since 1972 under that administration, again in 82, and now again in 93 and 95. And each time when it's been looked at and vetted, you have here a tax collector, you have here a regulator, and you have here an enforcement. If you move any one of them, you also have to move proportions of the other because they intertwine. It's very different from a normal law enforcement organization. So to tear it apart, and in everybody's view, after they've vetted it, each time to include Vice President Gore's National Performance Review Team just a few months ago, said that it ought to remain where it is, single, close oversight. This Bureau needs close oversight. It needs close oversight because every jurisdiction is controversial. Somebody said to me the other day, well, arson's not controversial. Well, it is when it involves an abortion clinic. And so you have to be very careful with these jurisdictions because of the kinds of things. And we have to make sure that we have close oversight so I understand exactly how you want us to work these jurisdictions. For instance, in the crime bill that just came up, there's a weapon in the crime bill that has that says that if you have a magazine of 10 or more rounds, it's not a valid way. It's a violation of the crime bill. But when you looked at a couple of weapons that are out there, that the old Western style that you cock each time did have a 10 magazine, a magazine for 10 rounds. We worked that out with the industry to try to, that isn't what your intent was. We knew it wasn't your intent. So to come across and say, no, you can't have that weapon, we've got to make sure we're doing that kind of thing. And that's, I think this Bureau has done a great job of interfacing with the alcohol and the tobacco industry over the years, not so good a job interfacing with the firearms industry, and we're going to do a better job at that.
You make a very good argument in that. You made a statement earlier, too, the more successful you are in keeping guns from criminals and prosecuting criminals, the less gun control will be needed. I certainly agree with that statement. I was glad to hear you say that. If you had an identical situation today, and I happen to believe that Koresh and the Davidians were not the only group like that out there across this country, if you had an identical situation today, how would you handle it?
Well, the first thing I would have done a long time ago, if I had the identical situation and were thinking about how to investigate it, is that I would confer not only with Treasury. Mr. Noble has placed a lot of oversight on these bureaus that was never there before. And he's kind of at a disadvantage in answering some of these questions because there weren't procedures before. I've served 7 administrations, and I think in that period of time, 8 assistant secretaries for law enforcement. And there was never been the oversight before, nor did they have guidelines, which he's now constructing working with us. So I think that part, obviously, if you're talking about it, we're doing some of that now with justice and all the other departments around the country that have law enforcement to try to draw on the best way to handle this situation, not operating in a vacuum. I've already discontinued 2 undercover cases because I couldn't protect it. If we went the next step, I could not protect the undercover agent, and I withdrew that undercover agent. We'll still make those kinds of judgments as we go along, sir.
So your answer is that you're working on how you would actually work one of those, and you and Mr. Noble can give us an answer at a later time as to exactly how you would address that. And well, I appreciate your forthright attitude. I appreciate the work you've gone to make some significant changes at ATF. Thank you.
Mr. Booyer, you're given 5 minutes.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Mr. Noble, bear with me for a second. I've been out in the committee room for about an hour and a half, and so if I'm redundant, just say you're redundant and I'll move on, all right? Thanks. I'll give you that courtesy and extend it likewise.
Forgive me if I'm slurring at this point.
All right, thanks. Something that it did catch my attention because of all the reading that I've done is this is the first time that I'm now learning that prior to the raid, when you had learned, someone had briefed you, I guess, on what some possible plan was, that you said, let's not do this. So that's why I have a few questions on that. When was that, when did you receive a briefing that caused you to have concerns about the raid? If you could help me.
On page 178 of the report,
all right,
second full paragraph, it explains that for you, sir.
All right, good. I can read, so I'll cover that. Let me ask a question about your order that the raid not go off.
I'm trying to be honest and yet not make it seem as though someone else is responsible. So when you say order, I was not authorized to order anything. I was a consultant. However, I'm saying that I addressed the situation as if I were in the position. So when I was giving advice to the acting assistant secretary, I, like many lawyers do, put myself in his position. So I'm trying to be accurate for the record, but not distance myself from the decision that was made.
If you were the acting and not, you felt uncomfortable not having the authority, did you bounce it?
I didn't feel uncomfortable, I just didn't have the authority.
Okay, then did you bounce it up to whomever did have the authority?
That's what I'm saying, is the person who had the authority, his name is John Simpson. He was the acting assistant secretary for enforcement. He's the person whom I advised about all the concerns I had. He's the person with the de jure and de facto authority who called off the raid or permit the raid to proceed.
All right. Whatever your gut reactions were, I salute you. I've got about 19 years of military background, and with regards to the tactics and planning, it was very, very poor. Part of Mr. Brewster's question that he asked you, Director, I'm not sure if I'm in agreement with your response, because as I sit through these hearings, I'm asking about the legitimate roles of government and our oversight functions, and I agree with you when you said ATF is an agency that needs close oversight. I mean, not only within the Treasury, but that's our purpose and function is constitutionally. And I have been bothered that, I guess from the Watergate hearings, it's almost laid down the marker in this town that if you have a congressional oversight hearing, that there must be a smoking gun. And I don't think that's necessarily true either, okay? So I want you to know that. I mean, up front with you. And I also, that's not a question.
I also, though,
know all the political garbage that's going on in the town, too. Back and forth. And I wish we could just get on with the business. But part of the questions that I go through is there a future for the ATF? That's what I'm asking myself. And if there is a future for the ATF, what kind of future is it? Or do we go back to the, don't call them ATF, we're going to call them revenuers again, I guess, sir. Moving firearms to FBI. I mean, I've been asking that question. I think Mr. Brewster's question was very good. And when you say, well, let's not really do that, because wouldn't that make them just a federal police force? Well, isn't that what ATF is now? So would you help me answer that question? I disagree with that.
ATF has fairly limited jurisdictions. Firearms, we don't get into financial institution fraud. We don't get into bank robbery, any of those things. The firearms, by the fact that it's a regulatory industry, it's also tax collected on that. It all fits very well in the Treasury scheme. And because firearms are so controversial and there's so much passion throughout the country, pro and con for them, I believe that you leave them in an agency like this where you have the close oversight. That's strictly my opinion and my judgment.
All right. Well, we're going to keep on that issue, because that'll be some of the carryover issues after this hearing. And right now I'm going to yield the balance of my time to Mr. Ehrlich. Thank you.
Whatever, 30 seconds.
Mr. Ehrlich, you will be recognized. I don't think we have somebody else on this side of the aisle that wants to go right now anyway. So you have the 30 seconds plus your own time. So go ahead.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Please indulge me for a second.
Sure.
we talk about political garbage. My colleague to my right just used the phrase political garbage, and a lot of us on both sides of the aisle are actually trying to get facts out. We appreciate your testimony here today. The source of my utter frustration with this town being here 6 months is comments like the following that were made at the White House press briefing today. In answer to a question to Mr. McCurry, how specifically are the Republicans trashing law enforcement, this answer was elicited. By implying to the American people that somehow or other, the conduct that they are looking at in Waco is representative of the way law enforcement officers behave, and the president is going to stand forthwith with law enforcement officers, four square with law enforcement officers. He is standing up for the law enforcement officers in this country who put their lives on the line while this Republican majority and this committee attempt to undermine confidence in law enforcement officers. I assure you both that's not my purpose, and I have a couple very specific questions for you. Mr. Noble, revisiting, hopefully for the last time, this whole military issue, and I'm just trying to get your conclusion straight. Is it your testimony that ATF, by training with the Joint Task Force number 6, it's my understanding that that training occurred only because of the presence of the allegation of a drug nexus. And is that a misunderstanding on my part, first of all? And if it's not, was that training appropriate, in your view?
It's my understanding that ATF gave information to the military about the drug-related activity, albeit back in 1989.
I think it was 87.
And, I'm sorry.
I think it was 87. But 80, whatever.
I think
whatever.
It was 89.
Okay.
87 or 89.
Okay.
And that the military was satisfied that that information was such that a particular component of it could assist ATF. And I believe that is the component that you just referred to, sir. Yes.
All right. Thank you. Thank you very much. Now, you both have talked about new guidelines that have been promulgated with respect to sensitive operations. And what I'd like you to do, and I really appreciate your testimony today from both of you, and I've tried to take pretty copious notes with respect to questions like Mr. Brewster's and the number of questions that have come along over the course of the last hour with respect to if a similar situation occurred today, what changes would take place today that would not have taken place under the old procedures, under the old personnel that were in place at the time. And I've tried to write down a number of the observations you both have made. One, supervisors were in the wrong place. Two, you would have consulted cult experts where cults are involved. Three, inspection, oversight, shooting, review team now in place. Four, the press would have been out of the way. Five, operational security would have been in place and personnel sensitized to the importance of operational security. And you've made a more general statement, not with respect to Waco, that you've discontinued a number of cover cases because you could not secure your personnel. Could you both please take a shot at giving us more examples of specifics that have changed as a result of this incident, both with respect to personnel and procedure?
Maybe I could take a shot at the policy level and then whatever Director McGaw would like
Great.
To say about the operational. At the policy level, what I believe has to happen and what I've tried to make sure happens is that once a case is initiated as, let's say, a sensitive case with undercover implications, that when that case is presented to the undercover review committee, that we have as diverse a group on that committee to make sure that whatever decisions are made, they're made from as wide a range of perspectives as possible. So we have undercover review committees embracing more than one bureau, first point. Second point.
And that certainly was not in place prior to Waco.
That's correct, sir. Right. The second point is that we invite the Justice Department's criminal division lawyers to have a seat on that undercover review committee and therefore get the benefit of their
oversight over justice-based operational matters so that, again, we have information coming in. That's just one concrete example of how early on we can address policy decisions, not 2 days before the raid goes, but when the case is first investigated or initiated. And I'd ask Director McGaugh to talk about operational.
Thank you very much.
Well, first of all, ATF will never again, as long as I'm the director, take up an operation this large by itself. So it cannot happen again, because we won't take this kind of an operation on. We're not capable of handling it by ourselves. Having said that, there are a number of things that we would work on, and we're in the process, working through Treasury and with Justice and everybody under Justice, to try to put some plans together so that we will be able to function in a large capacity like this as a team member. And some of the things you've already mentioned, I won't repeat. But what we've done already is we've provided crisis management training for all of our headquarters staff, and we're also doing it for all of our special agents in charge and the supervisors of our SRT teams. The other thing that when I came here, there were 24 SRT teams. There was one for each division. You have to remember now that ATF does an awful lot of search warrants because obviously explosives and guns are hidden. And so we execute an awful lot of search warrants. But 24 teams, how do you keep them properly trained? Do you overuse them when there's that many? My judgment was is that you do. And therefore, I've reduced that number to 6. They will be better trained, less used. And one of the things that is an overriding policy now is that when you have a search warrant or you're going to make an arrest or you have to search a property, try to find every way possible that you can without using a dynamic entry. Dynamic entry is absolutely the last choice, and you better kick it up to a supervisor above you, above the field lever to headquarters, before you activate that dynamic entry.
Mr. Ehrlich,
I want to thank you for your answer from both of you. The points you raise are the kind of specifics and the reason that we're here. Thank you very much.
Mr. Ehrlich, thank you very much. Mr. Coble, you're recognized for 5 minutes.
Chairman, gentlemen, it has been suggested that Oklahoma City triggered these hearings. Not true with me. 2 years ago, I tried to get these hearings conducted, not to bash anyone, not to embarrass anyone, but to illuminate an area of the federal government that appeared to be awash with conflicting stories. The post-Waco environment cried out for a hearing, it appeared to me. Mr. McGaugh, as you well know, law enforcement is a risk assumption business. And I care not what sort of perfections you insert, you will never be able to assure your law enforcement men and women that they will not have to assume risk. And I, along with the gentleman from Oklahoma and Maryland, I'm interested in the changes, and I want to get with you at a mutually convenient time. Let me revisit a point I made last week. We are today we are today experiencing the luxury of applying 20/20 hindsight. Unlike the guys and gals and women who were there the day it went down, the most plaguing feature of the Waco episode to me is the non-arrest of the charismatic, self-proclaimed prophet, head of the snake, the lead dog, the nerve center of the compound, call him what you will, but by the way of an arrest warrant, get him off the premises, remove him, maintain custody and control, even for just a few hours, execute the search warrant, conduct the search out of the presence of the leader of the compound. Now that is very simplified, I will admit. Here's what bothers me. The Treasury report at one point says Koresh, quote, apparently never left, close quote, and therefore couldn't be arrested. At the criminal trial, however, it was revealed that he did from time to time leave, in fact, as recently as 4 days prior to the raid. Then Treasury's defense perhaps subsequent defense, and I believe, Mr. Noble, in your words, an arrest would not have been a good idea because it would have resulted in evidence having been destroyed, or in the words of others, the Davidians resisting. Now, Mr. Noble, if you can, resolve this enigma for me. On the one hand, it appears that the Treasury report implied he never left, and therefore precluding arrest. Subsequently, it appears the Treasury report reflects that it would not have been a good idea to arrest for this reason or that reason. Talk to me, Mr. Noble.
First, I'd like permission following today's hearing to answer your question in writing specifically. Okay, I'll do it from my memory right now.
That's fine.
The first point is the Treasury Department report makes absolutely clear a bright line distinction. ATF believed, the raid planners believed, based on faulty intelligence, that Koresh never left the compound. This report, the Treasury report, states expressly that Koresh left the compound on a number of occasions, low number of occasions. The Treasury report expressly states that the option of arresting Koresh off the compound was not adequately considered. The Treasury Department report does not go through all the permutations that make your hypothetical realistic in New York City or Washington, D.C. or any city, but not realistic in Waco, Texas, and I say for the following reason. If Koresh did not leave the compound on a patterned basis so that the law enforcement agents could say, Sunday morning, 8 o'clock, he always goes into town. Every Sunday, 8 o'clock, he's in town. We can get all the law enforcement agents ready. When he goes into town, grab him, and then immediately execute the search warrants for the compound. If Koresh doesn't leave the compound on a pattern basis, then you have to have the number of agents necessary to execute search warrants secreted somewhere near Waco, Texas. Our report exposed the fact that even the hotel reservations that occurred on February 27th would have alerted someone as to the operational security risks involved. So I say it's just a hypothetical, it's a theoretical premise that you can both arrest someone and execute search warrants without the world finding out when the world is as modestly populated in that area. And I say that with all due respect. And also, just for the record, say on page 140, footnote 39 states the number of times we were able to identify that Koresh left the compound.
If you will, Mr. Noble, as you, and folks, I reiterate, I realize applying 2020 is a whole lot easier than having been there, but we're trying to keep it from repeating itself. That should be the purpose of the hearing.
We understand that.
Gentlemen, thank you all for being here, and I thank the gentleman from Florida.
Mrs. Thurman is still reserving her time, as is Mr. Schumer, so I will now recognize Ms. Ross Layton.
Yeah. Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I would like to yield my time to you.
Mr. Noble, I want to ask you just a couple of follow-up type of questions to clarify some of the record on this. At any time on the 26th, 27th, or 28th of February prior to the raid, did you have any contact by telephone or otherwise with any other ATF agent or officer other than Director Higgins?
And Mr. Kyler, sir?
And Mr. Kyler.
Yeah. No, sir.
All right, that's fair enough.
You're saying prior to the raid?
Prior to the raid.
That's correct.
I'm not worried about the rest. I just want to know prior
that's
to the
correct.
Raid. Fair enough. Now, I'd like to get to the bottom, if we could, of what has been somewhat a confusing trail of words over the past few days about the, quote, lost element of surprise. I think what disturbed Mr. Hartnett a great deal was a comment, I'll quote, that you made on a 60 Minutes program May 14, 1995, and I quote, what was absolutely clear in Washington at Treasury and in Washington at ATF was that no raid should proceed once the element of surprise was lost. Now, let me track this back with you for a moment. As we've heard testimony here over the past couple of days, Mr. Sarabin and Mr. Hojnoski have told us that they did not ever perceive that they had instructions or directions that if the element of surprise, or let's call it whatever, secrecy, was not there, that they were not to proceed with the raid, but they did say they understood that secrecy was an important part of this, but just that they didn't have any directions not to proceed if it wasn't there. Then we've heard Mr. Hartnett describe this situation, who was, of course, above them as the former deputy director of ATF, and he said as recently as today, nobody ever called and said, abort the raid if the element of surprise is lost. And I think that's probably true, because Mr. Higgins testified to us as well last week that at no time did he tell them, abort the raid if the element of surprise is lost. Now, he did say he assumed that they would not proceed if the element of surprise or if the secrecy involved was lost. The bottom line is, I haven't heard it said anywhere, and I don't think you said it when you were on 60 Minutes, that the Treasury Department, that you or Mr. Simpson or anybody else ever actually gave a direction straight out to Mr. Higgins or to Mr. Kyler not to proceed if surprise or secrecy was lost. You indicated to us, and so did Mr. Simpson, that you had received assurances from Mr. Higgins that it would that would not happen. You didn't demand from him, don't go do this if it's lost. You just assumed, too, from these assurances it wouldn't happen. Isn't that really what we're talking about here? Am I correct now? I've tried to review this as fairly as I know how.
The report reinforces what you say. Director Higgins gave assurances to John Simpson that if anything unusual or out of the ordinary occurred, the raid would not proceed. It, in my view, it seems it goes without saying that when you plan a raid to surprise someone and you learn at 45 minutes in advance they know you're coming, that if your plan was based on surprise and you're risking the lives of 76 agents, that you're not going to go forward with it. So our view wasn't one, and the report doesn't say it. The report says the director of ATF was personally involved, and he gave assurances that the people were told, were alerted, knew, would not go forward if anything unusual occurred following the undercover agents going into the compound,
right,
following the...
But you gave no orders that that be the case. That was just an assurance you had. I understand
And that's
that.
What the report says. The report...
No, I understand that. I'm not arguing with you. I'm just trying to clarify. I also want to make it clear that, because Mr. Hartnett and I think to a certain degree Mr. Higgins also have been concerned in their testimony before us, that there indeed was a spin that was put on this around the terminology element of surprise. And whether we agree with it or not, that undoubtedly is their perspective on this. And they believe that that point was being overdone because, as Mr. Hartnett put it to us today, his men were being left out there when he felt they really did not ever have orders to proceed, to not proceed without the element of surprise having been lost. And I think that's understandable, too. And I just want to clarify, though, so that the difficulties of talk and language here can be broken. And I think we have.
Well, I would just like to say for the record that the report on page 179 says, Higgins asserted that those directing the raid were instructed to cancel the operation if they learned that its secrecy had been compromised or if those in the compound had departed from their established routine in any significant way. It also states that on page 180, had the Waco raid commanders adhered to Director Higgins' assurance to Simpson and Noble that the raid would not go forward unless ATF had the advantage of surprise, the operation might have ended differently.
But
it's been our contention in the Department of the Treasury's report that only Mr. Hartnett and Mr. Hanowski and Mr. Serapin denied, because Mr. Higgins made it absolutely clear that this raid was not supposed to proceed if advantage of surprise was lost, and Mr. Aguilera testified about that being clear on February 12th as well.
We won't dispute that either, but the fact that they disputed is clear. I want to ask you one other question of my time. It has to do with the opportunity to do things that were not done, because this is a question, I think, of some great import, and it is not you personally we're dealing with, but I just want to ask you the question because it does have to do with comments you made earlier today in testimony. That it certainly is understandable that if you get to the point in time when you've got 48 hours to try to review something before a raid is going to happen, you've just been there a short time advising Mr. Simpson, he hasn't known about this, and the procedures are such as they were at the time at the Treasury, which you did not create, then the actions that you've described and the reactions are perhaps fairly understandable. But something that disturbs me a lot, and it disturbed me when I first learned it, I didn't expect to learn it here the other day, it was the fact that when Mr. Benson, and for that matter, Mr. Altman, first came aboard, which was somewhere around, give or take a couple of days, 30 days before this raid, the new administration had come into office in January, and they'd become in their respective, affirmed in their respective categories, Secretary of Treasury and Undersecretary, that in the interim between then, they did not have a sit-down meeting, particularly the secretary himself, with Mr. Higgins, either in a staff group, as you now do apparently rather regularly, and Mr. Altman apparently did after the 28th and said he might have done one time without maybe Mr. Higgins there before it. They didn't have a sit-down with the heads of the agencies, and they didn't have a particular personal contact, and certainly the secretary didn't, with Mr. Higgins, to just simply say, hey, tell me what's going on, give me an update, give me the general idea of what your agency's doing. I'm your new boss, if you will. The type of thing you and I probably would normally do. And if that had happened within a week or two of the time they'd taken office, there would instead have been 48 hours of time for you to look at this and snap judgments to be made and go back and forth with Simpson and you talking about this and so on as happened on the 26th and 27th of February. Just maybe there would have been a more deliberate look at all of these things that were going on down there, that you would have discovered there had been no raid plan, that people's attention would have come about, because surely Mr. Higgins would have raised the number one thing on his plate at that time if that type of discussion had taken place. Am I not correct in that assumption that is a criticism that should be placed, not a huge thing to come down with a great big hammer and say, you know, these guys are the primary villains in this piece, because they're not. But is it not fair for some of us to question that and to criticize the fact that those meetings never took place in that time frame, which I would assume, and I don't know, I'm asking you, most people would assume would normally take place when the secretary takes over a new position and an undersecretary does in the first month? Surely they'd meet with their principal law enforcement officials at least to say hello and what's going on in your shop.
I say that your characterization is unfair and inaccurate, and the reason for it is I met with Mr. Higgins shortly after being named as someone who might occupy the position of Assistant Secretary for Enforcement. Met with him for about an hour and a half, 2 hours before February 26th, and Steve Higgins never mentioned to me that they were undertaking a significant law enforcement operation. Now, if he didn't mention it to me during a two-hour meeting, I don't know how anyone could reasonably expect a Secretary of the Treasury who has 25 or 30 presidential appointees or bureau heads below him, just like an AG who has 25 or 30 people of that rank below him, would raise this when he didn't raise it with me. So I would say it's unfair and inaccurate, sir. Thank you.
Well, you're welcome. Thank you for explaining that. And I will yield 5 minutes then to Mr. Heineman.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Let me just pick up a little bit where you left off, and certainly answering the first perhaps question or issue facing us when you took the floor, Mr. Noble, was the fact that you were upset about people questioning your report. And I was one of them, and maybe the first, I don't know, but I did speak to it perhaps 2 days ago, and there were issues that did concern me about that time. And I don't think these issues have been cleared up. I think throughout the hearings, they've just been, it's just raised more questions as it relates to Mr. Serebrin's characterization of your report as being 70% accurate, 15% false, and 15% somewhere between. And I'm well aware that Mr. Serebrin was, if you call it, convicted of lying and demoted. But I don't know whether he was telling the truth here. I hope he was. He was under oath. And then to hear Mr. Hartnett characterize your report as distortions, falsifications, and omissions, and I'm well aware that he left the service right after the raid. I don't know whether he was retired voluntarily or he was asked to leave. But somehow, I get a very strong feeling that Mr. Hartnett was candid with us. Although I didn't hear much here to discredit the report other than that characterization, and hopefully, when he left here today, he said he would, he would expand in writing to us relative to what he meant by that characterization of your report. And prior to reading the book, I did hear rumors that David Koresh could have been captured as he was jogging each day. And of course, it was rumors. And I read your report, and I even passed on what the report had to say was that he seldom left the compound. And that's what's in the book when they were brainstorming as how to take David Koresh or conduct the raid. And in the book, it said that David Koresh seldom left the compound. And lo and behold, we get a witness here who lived inside the compound, Mr. Thibodeau, who under sworn testimony said that David Koresh generally jogged, I believe, the last 2 months, pretty much on a pattern. Now, I don't know whether that's, he testified under oath, and I don't know whether that's true either, because he was a Branch Davidian, and David Koresh did have power over them, and he may have just been speaking in retaliation to ATF. I don't know about that. But then as I read on about a plan, and I've been chasing a plan now since I've been speaking here for the past 4 days. Now, I've been in the business for some time, and I know an operation that takes 80 people. Certainly the SRTs were from different cities. We had the military involved. We had DEA involved. We had INS involved. And we had one of the largest ATF operations that ATF has ever conducted. Yet, I look for a comprehensive plan, as Mr. Higgins spoke to in this book when he spoke to Mr. Kyler and mentioned that he sent a memo and assures that a well-reasoned comprehensive plan had been approved, allowing for all contingencies. Well, that's reasonable. You would expect that. I would expect that. But yet there's no plan. I know I'm told that there are little plans. Perhaps each SRT has a plan. I don't know. But certainly if I'm responsible to my superiors and I have to let them know what's happening, especially if they're new, I would have to, and I would agree with you on Mr. Higgins, he should have brought it up. I would have to know that I have to send up a comprehensive plan dealing with several agencies, and I don't see that plan. The plan does not exist. And I have concerns about that. Did it ever exist? I just don't know. The basis of my doubts about this report reflect around that. And we also have, here it states Higgins asserted that those directing the raid were instructed to cancel the operation if they learned that its secrecy had been compromised. Yet I hear testimony here that I believe Mr. Hartnett and Mr. Hajnowski said, well, that was never an issue. But I have to say it's always an issue when you're conducting a raid. I mean, if you don't have secrecy, there's no need to raid the place. But that raises a lot of doubts in my mind about this. Not that you and your colleagues here tried to shade the impact of this report, but it's just hard for me as a professional law enforcement officer in my past life to accept some of these things as it relates to the plan and the questions raised by Mr. Hartnett. So I hope you don't take it personal that we question your work here, but it does raise a lot of issues that I think need to be resolved. And that's why I personally took issue with this, because I had a lot of concerns about things that I thought belonged in there and that just wasn't in there. And I'm not saying you left it out on purpose, but it's just a report that I have a little trouble with. You care to comment?
I would love to comment, if I may, Mr. Chairman.
You got the red light.
Red light means go now. Okay. A number of points, if I can recall them all, were made. First is whether or not this report is accurate. I believe that's fair inquiry. What I object to is when people say that the inquiry is this report a cover-up? Especially when the people making the allegations are never put to the test of saying, tell me what fact that's in this report is inaccurate, or what fact that's not included in this report ought to be included, and how that changes the core or central points. That's with regard to the report. I will wait to see what Mr. Hartnett says about why he believes there are omissions, distortions, or falsifications, I believe, were the words he used. Second point, with regard to your comment about the plan, you referred precisely to the language at the bottom of that one-page advisory that said all contingencies and blah, 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 blah have been accounted for, the classic boilerplate language. In fact, there was no raid plan even generated until the last minute. We included what they called the comprehensive raid plan in this report. Next point, with regard to your reliance on Mr. Hanowski and Mr. Serafin, we have in this report the altered raid plan, how they tried to change it after the raid went bad, putting in facts that if they were in before the raid went bad would make them look more credible. So I know, Chief, you have a lot of experience, and I respect your taking issue with certain points or aspects of this report. I would only hope that having heard these allegations made by interested parties, that you would await to see what actual omissions or commissions they point to before concluding finally whether this is 100% accurate or 99% accurate. Thank you, sir.
Mr. Blute, you're recognized for 5 minutes.
Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman. I thank the witnesses for their testimony. I just want to follow up on what my colleague had to say just briefly about the plan. It's true that there was no plan, and there were a lot of things going on that would indicate that there probably should have been a plan, and I think your report indicates that. But it's
written
also
plan. Written plan.
Written plan. But it's also true that high-level Treasury officials okayed a massive quasi-military operation without a written plan. Is that the case?
We have never shied away from what we did.
So clearly, at the highest levels of the Treasury Department, they okayed
the highest levels of the Treasury Department are the Acting Assistant Secretary for Enforcement, then that's correct, sir.
Okay, because as you know, a Department of Defense memo indicated that the plan had been okayed by the highest level of the Department of Treasury.
Well, if it says that, it's inaccurate, because I don't consider the Acting Assistant Secretary for Enforcement the highest level of the Treasury Department.
I understand. Beyond that, let me say that I personally believe these hearings have been very beneficial. I am a relatively new member of Congress in my 2.5 years or about. I look down the aisle here and I see a lot of people have been here about 6 months. We think these are important hearings. We are learning about how the Bureau of ATF operates and how we can perhaps make it improved in the future. We're certainly learning about the mistakes that were made by the Bureau during this incident. I personally resent any inference by anyone on this committee or in the White House or anywhere that we shouldn't ask the tough questions of federal law enforcement, and that in asking those questions somehow we are undermining federal law enforcement. I think that's totally absurd, and I think it's totally wrong. And I wondered if you think that by asking tough questions of federal law enforcement, that somehow we're trashing federal law enforcement.
Let me respond to the first part and second part. With regard to the approval by Maine Treasury of the raid plan, I would say that of the 5 tactical operations experts who looked at this and volunteered their time, 4 of the 5 said that the plan, as the raid planners understood it, had a reasonable chance of success. So not just Maine Treasury, experts who looked at it. The second point in terms of these hearings, I agree with you in part and take issue with you in part. I agree that you can ask any question you want. It's your right, we're obligated to answer. What I am personally offended by, is when people will attack something as a cover-up or as being dishonest as the first line of inquiry. I think that you can attack the report and assume that it's been generated by honest, hardworking, dedicated career and other civil servants who are trying to do the right thing. If there are mistakes, then we should learn the mistakes and it will help us all be better. But to move from I find a word that's not here or a sentence that's not here and say cover up, I think, is a disservice to people who dedicated themselves
but
to get to the truth.
Agreeing on that point, if it is true that somehow some people on the committee didn't characterize that plan, the report the right way, do you believe that asking tough questions is trashing federal law enforcement?
I believe it's a very important role that you play in asking the tough questions that you ask on both sides of the aisle.
Well, I would hope that you would mention that to your colleague, Mr. McCurry, the White House press secretary, who just today said that these hearings somehow are trashing federal law enforcement. Nothing could be further from the truth. We're trying to exercise our constitutionally mandated oversight responsibility. I'm someone who voted for the Brady bill, voted for the assault weapons ban, think that the ATF has an important role in our federal law enforcement efforts. And I just think that any inference by anyone, particularly as high as the White House, is absolutely too bad, because this is our responsibility. And I take my responsibility serious to the 600,000 constituents that I represent. Beyond that, let me just finally ask a tough question, because I think it's important. We've heard a lot of testimony about the good in the ATF. We've heard about the bravery of Mr. Rodriguez and Mr. Buford and many others on that raid and many other raids that the ATF are involved in. But frankly, we've also heard about the worst of the ATF, and the report indicates some of the worst. I think this hearing has brought forth some of the worst of the ATF, the fact that warnings were ignored about the fact that Koresh already understood that a raid was happening. That's an incredible revelation to hear about, both in your report, but also here in person. And beyond that, we've also had indications of ATF agents attending things like racist roundups, which has been in the news recently, and I know which is an issue for another day. I think this is a legitimate question. Is there, within the ATF, according to all of your reviews, some type of Rambo element? Not everyone, but is there a group of ATF agents from your review of what has been happening that are out of control, that are not following proper procedure?
Let me answer that as directly as I can. In my observation and my talking with our personnel and seeing them in action, they live in a very, very violent world. They live in all kinds of old clothes, long hair. A great percent of our work is undercover. When they make arrests, they need to go into these buildings and take quick control for the safety of everyone, and they do it every day with a lot of success. So that there is a self-assuredness. There is a strongness of voice. There is a get control of the situation. You saw in Rodriguez today a very quiet person, but also a very strong person in terms of what he said. I will go in there knowing they know it, facing the weapons if you ask me to do it. So what I am attempting to do is, as we go along, is that when you live in that kind of a violent world, it's very difficult when you come out of that violent world for a few hours to deal with a gun collector or a gun dealer or a manufacturer, that you don't carry some of that activity. So what I want to make sure is that we do an interchange back and forth and an interfacing better, and we do that through training and sensitivity and awareness. And so there is not the Rambo, but it does have some smoothing that we need to do.
Well, let me thank you, both of you, for your testimony and say that I look forward to working with both of you to strengthen the ATF, to make it a viable federal law enforcement agency in the future, and most importantly, to regain the confidence of the American people in this agency and others, particularly in light of what happened at Waco, Texas. Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you, Mr. Bloot. Mr. Watt, you're recognized for 5 minutes.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Mr. Noble, Mr. McGaul, I assume both of you know what a Monday morning quarterback is. You're familiar with that term. It seems to me that by definition, a lot of what we are doing on this committee and have been doing is Monday morning quarterbacking. We have the benefit of what has already transpired to inform us, to make us better able to make decisions because we can make those decisions and evaluate those decisions through hindsight and with information that you did not have available to you at that time. So I'm going to give you an opportunity to do a little Monday morning quarterbacking and satisfy us, if you would. In hindsight, knowing what you know now, is there anything that you would have done different with respect to the Waco incident? And if you would, then take away some of the facts that you now know that you didn't know then and work your way back to the decisions that you made at the time. Mr. Noble, let me ask you to go first on that question.
I've been struggling with this for a couple of years now, trying to write an article to address similar problems in the future, and I don't have the answer. I have a couple off-the-cuff thoughts, but they're not completely worked out. One thing that comes to mind in a traditional law enforcement matter raises alarms in this matter, and that is the possibility, if you had some kind of bug in the compound at the time the undercover agent went in there, and if it was clear in the way that it gathered information and you could process it immediately, think about how we would be able to know prior to a raids going forward whether or not the people inside were taking any defensive actions. It's just one quick observation. Another observation would be the whole question of how do you approach this group and how do you determine how to deal with someone who is as powerful and has such control over his followers as David Koresh and are able to do what Mr. Coble suggested, sort of get him away from the compound and yet have your people positioned to move in. Those are not very articulate observations, but I would have pushed everything to the front end to June and July of 92 and 93 and had all of that time to think about how to approach this individual and this group, and not had such critical decisions or factors being considered for the first time on February 26th.
Mr. McGough.
My answer, Congressman, would be, first of all, that I would not have handled an event like this again by myself. So if you'd back up somewhere after the delivery company talked about weapons being delivered to the compound, and I realized that it was a large number, and I realize now that I had a religious group that had a questionable background in terms of their violence, and that at that point I would have reached out and included some of the experts who knew that kind of information about them, had background, had history. I would have involved other members of Treasury, such as the Secret Service and Customs, and gone over to Justice and involved the leaders of those organizations in terms of how do we plan that. And that's, in fact, what we're doing right now, trying to plan how an event like this could have been handled in the past. Specific things, I still believe, if those two supervisors would have been in the right place, if they'd have been in the observation house across the street, away from all excitement. You can't be in a helicopter. Of course, my experience has told me that a long time ago because I've had a lot of experience with helicopters and protection. You can't communicate very well unless you put your own communication system in. So you can't count on that as a communication. And then your other one was right there where all the activity was going on. I believe if those two men would have been over there and they would have seen Rodriguez's face and his expression and what he said, and the emotion he said it with that day, they would have stopped that raid right then.
And both of you have been very responsive, but I have not heard either one of you say anything that that we could, as a Congress or as two committees of Congress, recommend to Congress we write into law to force this kind of retroactive knowledge that you've talked about. None of the things that you've mentioned here are things that that we could have required you to do legislatively. Is there anything in retrospect legislatively that you could recommend that we could do as Congress to keep some future incident of this kind from occurring again?
I would say that having the opportunity to have people in the position of oversight matters. This Congress has cut my budget by a third beginning October 1st, 1995. So what I'm fearful about is when October 1st rolls around, my office, which is already thin, is going to be down a third, and that something might go wrong, and I'll be explaining why I didn't read a memo that came across my desk more carefully, why I didn't take a phone call that I should have taken, why I didn't return a phone call. Now, that's not purely legislatively, but it's certainly in your function. And the other part I'm really reluctant to mention because it raises a whole host of civil liberties issues, and that is the question of whether or not law enforcement agents ought to be empowered to use electronic surveillance or bugs purely for safety reasons on the day of the raid or day before the raid, as opposed to for collection of evidence that might be used to implicate someone.
Mr. Bryant?
McGaugh, respond to
Oh, Mr. McGaugh, yes, he may, certainly.
I don't have any legislative thoughts in mind because I'm concerned about legislation, and those people who want to get around legislation can figure that how to do it, and it also may tie our hands. What I'm concerned about each time an administration changes is that this position is often not filled and confirmed for 7 or 8 or 9 months. And during that period of time, we don't have the oversight that we ought to have. This administration has more oversight and did from the very day that Mr. Noble walked on board, prior to, even though he wasn't confirmed, he was here as a consultant, prior to that, it was very clear, all the bureau heads, myself still sitting over to Secret Service, knew that there was going to be much closer oversight. I welcome that. I welcome the questions that congressmen are asking on all across the committee. But I don't think of any specific legislation, sir.
Mr. Bryant, you're recognized for 5 minutes.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Welcome, Mr. Secretary. Would you, while you've got your blue book out, go ahead and turn to page D-16. D-16. And welcome, Mr. Director, also. I'm trying to get to the point, Mr. Secretary, to clarify, I think going back to Mr. Shabbat, the issue of whether or not on the day of the raid of February the 28th, 1993, how far up in Washington was it that people knew that the element, the so-called element of surprise, had been compromised? In beginning of, this is a diary by time that's an ATF diary. It's in your report beginning about 9:05 in the morning. We see that Rodriguez departs compound at 9:05 in the morning, talks to Kavanaugh, calls Serban, who's at the command post, and in Serban, Wozniacki and Royster discuss Rodriguez's information and decide to go. So clearly this illustrates that Rodriguez left, talked to Serban, and then Serban, Wozniacki, and Royster talked about what Rodriguez told them, and then they made the decision to go at that point. And then at 9:10, about 5 minutes later, Wozniacki called the National Command Center in Washington and informs that the operation is a go. Now, what is this National Command Center? Is that the sort of the crisis center in Washington?
It's the ATF headquarters office where I believe Mr. Gardner, Mr. Vita, and those are the only two I'm certain were there at that point. I don't recall who else. There's someone else who was there. I just can't recall what the name is. But it's like a phone bank, if you will, set up precisely to take information with regard to the raid. Yes, sir.
So, in effect, that's the Washington point that's monitoring this raid that day.
That's correct.
These folks down in the field need to call Washington. They call the command center and talk to one of these two gentlemen, and then they can contact you or Mr. Benson or Mr. Altman or whatever.
No, you can stop right at ATF. And I know people would love to take this up the chain of command, and unfortunately the facts aren't there. In an operational matter like that, you would not want civilian oversight
If you could design the model, you do not want civilian oversight to be engaged in an operational matter that close to the time it occurs. The call, as I understand it, looking at this, went from Texas to Washington, and the critical point is, to this day, Mr. Hanosky doesn't admit, will not admit to this committee or to anyone, that he knew that surprise had been lost. So whatever he communicated, if he's consistent with his communication today, he won't admit to this day that he knew surprise was lost.
So there's no proof, as far as you're concerned, that Washington was ever told that morning before the raid that the element of security or secrecy had been compromised?
I'm saying the proof is the opposite. The proof is with Mr. Hanosky making the phone call and protecting himself now, there's no doubt in my mind that he will go on and on and on and on, refusing to accept responsibility for having authorized a raid to proceed. And I understand, part of me understands it, but what he did to Robert Rodriguez, I think, is unforgivable.
Well, if Mr. Wasnowski would confess up to this, or if in fact it occurred, that he did call Washington and tell them that the element had been compromised, what would Washington's obligation have been at that point, whoever answered the phone there?
You're asking me a hypothetical premised on a fact I know not to be true.
I certainly can ask you a hypothetical.
Hypothetically, if a raid commander called Washington and said that the undercover agent left the compound and reported to him in a very nervous fashion, that Koresh had dropped a Bible, that he was shaking,
okay,
that he looked out
right,
the window and said ATF and National
from.
Guard.
Okay.
Thank you.
If you would look at number 21 there, that document that was given to you, it's redacted on it. And I think the members have this copy of the document. Number 21, and I'd refer you specifically to, it's unnumbered, but paragraph 4, you see here that blank, and I'm going to refer to blank because it's redacted, blank entered the CP, which I guess is command post here in Waco, and proceeded to the radio room. Blank asked the clerk to get headquarters and Kavanaugh at the undercover on the telephones. Blank informed Vita, whom you referred to as in Washington at the command control, informed Vita in Washington that the teams were en route and that they were almost at the compound. Vita asked Blank why the teams were going early. And Blank informed him of Howell's, and I guess that's Koresh, Howell's comments to the undercover, who I assume is Rodriguez. Vita again asked why they were going early based on these statements, and Blank said he did not know. Blank kept the telephone line open between headquarters and so forth. And it goes on to say that, well, it talks about the rest of the raid there. But here very clearly is where whoever Blank is talked to Mr. Vita in the headquarters in Washington and informed him of Mr. Koresh's comments to the undercover agent when Mr. Vita asked why they were going so quickly, why they were leaving early.
May I ask the chairman's indulgence and stop the clock for just a second? Let me ask my colleagues back here and then give you an intelligent answer.
Good.
May I?
Certainly, may you.
Mr. Chairman, while they're talking, could I make this an attachment for the record?
Certainly, without objection.
Number 21. I might also, for the record, indicate that this document, number 21, it was not a part of the report, the blue report. I think it's a document that
came over. It's one of the, it looks like one of the photocopy of a memorandum of interview. And there were thousands of sheets of the memorandum of interview, and this report, as Chief Heineman said before, is already too long, so not all those memorandum of interview are included in this report.
Right. It appears to have been generated by the investigation, and it was disclosed, looks like, as part of the documents from the White House. It has the number on the bottom.
Looks like we have serious discussions behind me back here, but we'll get to the answer, I'm sure.
If I might ask, while we're waiting, can I switch gears on you?
Sure.
When did you start working as a consultant with the ATF?
I was a consultant with Maine Treasury.
Okay, I'm sorry, Maine Treasury.
My responsibility included ATF. I was trying to find out the date. I believe it's January 25th or 6th or 7th. It was either a Wednesday or a Thursday or Friday towards the end of January, and I just don't remember the exact date. It's one of those things I keep saying on my checklist I should find out when I first started, but one of those days.
And I recall you said that you worked on Wednesday, Thursday, and Friday.
My last class at NYU Law School concluded at 10 o'clock in the morning. I take a cab to LaGuardia, fly down, and then take a cab to the office.
Now, your meeting that you said you had with Mr. Higgins, who was the director of the ATF at that time, that was just simply a get-acquainted meeting?
Well, I don't know if Director McGaw would admit it, but once they learn that there's someone who might occupy the position, it travels like wildfire. So I went to play courtesy calls on all the directors. John McGaw was Director of Secret Service, Steve Higgins, ATF. Brian Brew was FinCEN. George Weiss was not yet nominated, so it was Michael Lane, and then my office directors today.
Did you meet with other people in Mr. Higgins' office? I mean, did you go to his office? Or did
I went to his office. I wanted to show them that I recognized that they were the power center and that I was going to be respectful of them and the experience they had, so I went to their office. And Mr. Higgins' secretary or administrative assistant,
I think they're leaving now.
That worries me. Introduced me to Mr. Higgins, and then I went in his office and had a one-on-one.
Were other people brought in as a part of Mr. Higgins' staff?
They were not. They were not. At none of the offices I visited for some reason.
Yours? All right. Mr. Bryant.
Wait. With Director McGaw, I met with him privately in his office, then you took me to a staff meeting. Okay.
Mr. Bryant, your time had expired. They're still trying to figure out this document. When the appropriate time comes, Mr.
Okay,
Noble, you'll be able to answer the question,
okay.
But I cannot let Mr. Bryant ask more at this point, and so I'm going to yield time now to Mr. Condit. You've got 5 minutes.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Mr. Secretary and Mr. Director, nice to have you here today, and I know it's been a long day, and I'll try to be quick. I'm still a little unclear about the investigative part of this, the process by which you folks do your internal investigation if you have a shooting, an officer goes down or what have you. It's my understanding that the Texas Rangers did an investigation, that the Justice Department did an investigation. Do you not have an internal process by which, when you have an incident, a gun has been fired, that you automatically go in investigate?
I'm sorry, sir.
I'm sorry, go ahead.
The standard operating procedure for ATF at the time was, following a shooting, there would be a post-shooting review.
Right.
They began the post-shooting review process, and during that time, two things happened. One is the Assistant U.S. Attorney in charge, Mr. Bill Johnston, made what I thought was the right decision and concluded that if ATF agents were the case agents for this murder investigation, then they would be accused of a whole host of misdeeds, which might make the case less strong than it otherwise would be. Therefore, Mr. Johnson asked the Texas Rangers whether they would agree to be special deputized U.S. Marshals and conduct a federal criminal investigation. Now, at the same time this is going on, there are reports in the newspaper and in the media, and in fact, I believe one agent went on TV saying that we knew, we being the ATF agents involved in the raid, knew that the surprise was lost and went forward nonetheless. And ATF headquarters was putting out the story that they didn't know that surprise was lost. Therefore, if we had permitted ATF to continue its post-shooting review, as it ordinarily had, then that critical fact of what did you know when, coupled with agents saying there's a cover-up going on, would have made that a dangerous thing to permit to continue. And for those reasons, the ATF was told to discontinue the post-shooting review, and the Texas Rangers began their criminal investigation.
Well, is that part of the procedure? If you think there is a problem with integrity, you automatically move to another agency?
Absolutely. Well, let me put it this way. I say, with the exception of the FBI, I think the FBI conducts its own internal investigations and has a component that does it nonetheless. But while I was at Treasury, while I've been at Treasury, if any of my components are accused of integrity violations, then I would pull it out of that component and have one of my other investigative components conduct the investigation or have the IG conduct an investigation.
So this would be one where you would say integrity was challenged, not necessarily just based on fact.
Right.
Congressman, an example of that is the good old boy roundup in Tennessee. We were the first bureau to start working that case, and as I developed it, I saw that in addition to ATF being involved, that others were involved. And I wanted to make sure that nobody would look back and look at this as a tainted investigation. I'm satisfied we would do a very good one. So I went over to see Mr. Noble as soon as I had a reasonable amount of information, and it's his judgment it should be turned over to the Inspector General. So that has been done. So that's an example of what we would do.
Am I correct? Texas Rangers did their investigation, the Justice Department?
They did.
How about the Treasury Department, then what?
Pardon me?
The Treasury Department as well?
The Texas Rangers, within a matter of days and weeks of the raid, conducted, I believe, 82 interviews. They were tape recorded and transcribed. The Treasury Department conducted over 500 interviews. We were all able to conduct the investigations the way we thought were appropriate.
Okay, and each investigation, Texas Rangers, the Justice Department, the Treasury Department, and you did not do your own internal, do you think they're all accurate?
Do I think what's
what are the findings of the three investigations? Would you agree with?
I believe what we did was a comprehensive, honest look at what happened. We turned the memoranda of interview over to the trial lawyers involved in the prosecution of the 11 defendants, eight of whom were convicted, and I think six of whom got 40 years plus. So I believe the Treasury Department's investigation and the criminal prosecutions confirm that what's in here is accurate and what came out of trial is accurate. And unfortunately, what Mr. Hanowski and Mr. Serapin and Mr. Hartnett continue to say is not the truth.
Did the Justice Department encourage you not to do your own internal?
Absolutely not, and if they had, I would have referred it to someone for criminal prosecution.
Okay. Mr. McGaugh, you want to respond to that?
Well, back in time, I was sitting at the Secret Service as the director, and Mr. Noble, I know, confided in me one day as to how to conduct this investigation so that it would be looked at by all when it was finished to be a valid one. And we decided that ATF should not be involved at all, and we talked to Steve Higgins, and he agreed with that. I then selected personally, as the director, personally went through our roster and selected seven outstanding people from the Secret Service, never realizing I'd be in this position today. And I had them all in the director's office, and I said, you're taking on a tremendous task here. You have to let the chips fall where they may, and if anywhere along the way you run into something that somebody's not allowing you to pursue, I want to know about it immediately. And I interfaced with the leader of that group, Louis Merletti, who you saw testify here in the last couple days, and he checked with me almost weekly, and there was never a case where they were not allowed to pursue anything that they came about. So I believe the report. I also look back as a young agent at the Kennedy investigation, and there are Secret Service agents today who will look at the Warren report and say, well, this isn't quite the way it happened. So there's always going to be that, and I believe that's what we have here more than anything else.
Thank you. I appreciate it.
Thank you, Mr. Condit. Mr. Souter, you're recognized for 5 minutes.
That the conversation with Mr. Vita is not in the time log, and I hope that will be in the explanation as well, because that's the type of thing that leads people to wonder why the Treasury wouldn't have included phone calls to itself in Washington when you were doing the investigation. And there may be a good explanation. I know you're working at that, but if you'll include that, it's on page in D16. This memo says 9:10 to 9:15. There's no such phone call reported in the document. Also, you made a reference, Mr. Noble.
I'm sorry, I'm not sure. I just want to make sure we get it right. What is the omission?
The phone call to Washington to Mr. Vita.
There's a 9:10 entry that says Hanowski calls the National Command Center in Washington, D.C. and informs the operation is a go. What is missing? I'm sorry?
My understanding is, and that's what I would like clarified in the question, is that this call?
Oh, so is that? Okay, we'll check
to Vita. Yes, because if that's the call, then it would have been helpful to note who it was to, but if it's not the call, then we need to identify who the
yes,
caller
sir.
Is. Otherwise, there'll be a whole cottage industry that develops around that. Also, as far as you made a reference to reduction in your office and that not knowing how oversight hearings are going to be, I would suggest that whenever you send two cattle trailers of agents into a raid and with helicopters, that probably you ought to know what's going on, particularly if four agents get killed and 21 children, you'll probably have some kind of oversight. I don't think we're expecting you to know every little detail of every raid, but this was the largest raid in ATF history, and that's why there are so many questions with it.
I don't understand your comments.
You made a comment about the size of your office. You're getting a 30% reduction. You can't watch over everything. We're not talking about everything in your office.
You don't need to impress upon me the loss of four agents' lives, sir, and I resent that. I resent that.
Flippant way to our oversight hearing, and I was responding that
I resent that. I just want the record to be absolutely clear on this one point. Not you, but anyone needs to impress upon me, sir, about what happened to four agents on February 28, 1993 near Waco, Texas.
So I made no flip remark to that.
Don't you lecture us about what our oversight authority is and talk about the cutting the budget and how that makes it difficult. Obviously, we both know.
I was asked a question by Mr. Watt about what we could do legislatively.
It is my time. And all, I was not trying to insult your integrity. What I was saying is when there's a large event such as this, of course there's going to be oversight. Whether or not your budget's reduced or not, you know
Sir,
that.
Sir, it makes a difference. If I have one-third less people there, then that means everything I do less thoroughly. So maybe I will miss that. Maybe
when
I just won't
When it's the largest raid in history, it has nothing to do with this hearing, and you know that.
I don't know that, sir. I take issue with what you're saying.
My question with to Mr. McGaw, I have a couple questions. On the what percentage are alcohol tobacco arrests in your agency as opposed to gun? Do you know, just from ballpark?
Yeah, just be around 5 or 6%.
What percentage of your arrests are convicted people you arrest? Is it a
it's
high percentage?
In the 90s, in the 90%, it's somewhere around 96 or 97%.
Are most dangerous, dangerous in the sense of imminent danger or potentially dangerous?
This is what I'm addressing, our priorities, and it's one of the things that we're looking down the road on. I want you to work on cases that are violent offenders. The drug traffickers, I mean, the gun traffickers, and those that are they're committing the violent offenses throughout our neighborhood. Those are the key cases that we work, and that's what we're putting our attention towards.
One of the things that I really appreciate about your demeanor and how you've handled yourself here is you're very soft-spoken. I think you seem very responsible. I think in the with all the tension in the country with ATF, that's important right now. And I don't think any of us, particularly on the Republican side, want to see a bunch of flower children going into these type of things. But we do want to make sure there's caution. And I was concerned in your statement where you said, I think it was about the fourth page, you said down further that that the image of ATF personnel as agents looking for a fight is utterly at odds. And then the paragraph before, your speechwriter, and I don't think they quite meant it this way, said your central mission was fighting dangerous criminals. Part of your responsibility, and I think you're trying to communicate that to agents, see, and it's one of the things we want to see happen, is much more caution, much more concern about what Mr. Blut was raising about whether they are hot dogging or too aggressive. At the same time, we're not asking them to be passive going in because it's dangerous situations. But I think the terminology is important. Many of these are not criminals in the sense they've not been convicted yet, and that's a fine line that we need to keep in mind in American law. No matter how evil we see David Koresh. I have another question, too, and that is that according to the report, it says that the reason the agents didn't go in was because they were concerned about a siege and the mass suicide. One of the questions that I've had, and we're going to get into the fire and other things, is that the first raid, in fact, didn't lead to fire. There was no evidence of gas being spread around, no evidence of mass suicide in the compound. And it, in fact, even in the second, until the tanks started to knock down the walls and there was some exchange going on as the gas was coming in, did the gasoline start to get spread on that. Now, the core question that I have with that is that this report suggests that the main reason was the siege question. Yet another document, if that could be distributed to you, is 00019385. Suggest that the reason that ATF did not go in was because you didn't have the negotiators or expertise as opposed to the mass suicide question. You're very, Mr. McGaw, you're very point that you don't think you can do these things alone anymore acknowledges that, but why do you think the report said the reason you didn't go in was because of mass suicide, and yet this document suggests it was because of the siege?
See, I'm not your best witness on that report. I came after that.
Mr. Noble, do you know what...
What is this document that I've been handed, sir? Can you tell me its source?
It's a Treasury report. I assume it's a similar one of the interviews.
I'm really sorry, but would you mind if we try to find out the answer to that? Yeah. I would simply say that the report cataloged and listed the reasons which ATF had for why it concluded that a siege would not work and why the absence of negotiators, I just will have to think about this. I'm hearing it for the first time now. So if you could give me a moment, maybe after everyone concludes,
okay,
there's one now for Mr. Bryant and one for
right.
you, sir.
And the core question here is that was the thrust the mass suicide, because there wasn't evidence that there was going to be a mass suicide until the action started, not under ATF but under FBI, right. And there wasn't in the ATF raid any attempt at mass suicide, and yet that was what really the report stresses, whereas this document...
Well, that was ATF's reason. One of ATF's reason for why a siege didn't occur was the risk of mass suicide. Another reason was that because they had 50 caliber rounds, the perimeter would have to be so great a distance. Another reason was they had provisions and provisions to last them for several months. So there were a number of reasons why the siege option was, and then there was also the destruction of evidence risk. But we'll find out that answer.
Thank you,
sir.
Mr. Noble, you're not yet ready to answer those other questions of Mr. Bryant, I guess, are we? If not,
Do you know, Mr. Chairman, whether there's going to be another vote or break at any point?
We're going to have it coming right up. If you need that time, you're going to get it. If we can, if Ms. Thurman, if you are ready to go, we would have time for 5 minutes of questions, so why don't we do that? I'll yield to you 5 minutes.
Okay. First, let me yield to the gentleman from North Carolina, Mr. Watt.
I thank the gentlelady for yielding, and I just want to take enough time to make it absolutely clear to Mr. Noble that I did not think that his response to my question was flippant at all. I thought it was thorough, and in the spirit in which I offered the question, and I appreciated it.
Thank you, sir.
Could I ask one question, please? Are the witnesses in some stage of duress? Should we retest these?
I've been crossing my legs, but it's not visible for some time now.
Well, I think, Mr. Chairman, they've only been here since 3:30. Don't you think that we might be able to accompany the witnesses in their requests, accommodate them in their requests while we take care of our duties on the floor?
We're going to definitely accommodate them. I would just let Ms. Thurman have her time.
Can I reclaim my time here so that, thank you. Mr. Noble and Mr. McGough, one of the things that my constituents... Excuse me.
The gentleman has already indicated that he is in
some duress.
We will take a break. We will come back and let Ms.
Thank you very much.
Full time here, as we need to have it. We will recess until...
Thanks for your generosity, Mr. Chairman. You're a wonderful person.
We'll continue with this hearing in a few minutes. First, some programming information.
Coming up this weekend on C-SPAN, live coverage of the National Governors Association summer meeting in Vermont. We'll bring you the opening news conference, live interviews and call-ins, and the opening plenary session. On America and the Courts, a review of Supreme Court Justice Robert Jackson's role in the Nuremberg trials following World War II. That's followed by Hillary Rodham Clinton's speech at a Women's Economic Security Conference in Denver. Also Saturday, a look at movies, values, and politics with Jack Valenti, president of the Motion Picture Association. Later, House Speaker Newt Gingrich in his address at the Ronald Reagan Center for Public Affairs. Sunday, on Road to the White House, former chairman of the Joint Chiefs of Staff, Colin Powell. That's followed by Book Notes with Emmy Award-winning journalist John Hockenberry and his book, Moving Violations, War Zones, Wheelchairs, and Declarations of Independence. Saturday morning, our public affairs programming continues at 11 a.m. Eastern Time with live coverage of the National Governors Association summer meeting. Saturday night, America and the Courts at 7 Eastern Time. That's followed by Hillary Rodham Clinton's speech at 8 Eastern and Pacific Time. Next at 9, Movies, Values, and Politics. Then an address by Newt Gingrich at 10 p.m. Eastern and Pacific Time. Sunday night, Road to the White House at 7 and 10. Then Book Notes at 8 Eastern and Pacific Time.
We now continue with the House Joint Subcommittee hearing of federal actions at Waco, Texas, in the spring of 1993. Republican Congressman Bill Zeliff of New Hampshire and Bill McCollum of Florida co-chair the Joint Subcommittee. This portion of the hearing runs an hour.
This joint hearing of the subcommittees on the Waco matter will come to order. At the time that we had our recess commencing a few moments ago, we were ready for Mrs. Thurman to have her 5 minutes, and I will give you your 5 minutes now. You may take it.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, and I appreciate your indulgence. One of the questions that's been going on all day on this dynamic entry, I'm curious in training, when they're being trained in this area. I mean, isn't dynamic entry the one thing that they talk about, is it was secrecy or the element of surprise or however you do that? I mean, shouldn't they just know that? I mean, does it really have to come from a higher command? I mean, is that not a part of their training to know that that is supposed to do, that's what's supposed to happen? I mean, I'm just curious to know the answer.
When you're referring to a dynamic entry, if they don't know it, they should know that is knock, announce yourself, give them a reasonable time to open the door, and if they don't get it open, then you go on in because evidence may be destroyed or moved or somebody armed themselves. And clearly, surprise is part of that, and that's why you do it. It's the same thing. People come up and knock on the door and sometimes get shot straight through the door if they're not smart enough to stay to the side of the door. So, you know, it's a dynamic entry, clearly, is one of surprise, to catch them before they can either destroy evidence if it's a case of drugs or if it's in a case of weapons before they can arm themselves.
So they would know that. I mean, there should be no question in their mind that if, in fact, that surprise is taken away, that they should be looking at either one, an alternative which was not available to them, or abort that particular procedure at that time.
That's correct. And that happened here in the District of Columbia just a few weeks ago when we were you may have read about it in the paper, we caught a lot of heat, you know, ATF messes up again and an announcement got out. Well, our forward teams were out the night before and they saw things they didn't like. And as a result, they realized by seeing what they didn't see, and used to seeing, that something was up. Well, it showed in later in a couple of days that a city official unintentionally let the information get out and it was on the radio. So our leader with about 180 or 90 people, all different departments out at Andrews Air Force Base being briefed at 3:30 in the morning and said, we're not going. And so it does happen and you have to have that element of surprise.
And I would think, Mr. McGaugh, when you've been training them and they're in this kind of a situation, that there is a certain amount of responsibility that they take individually as being in the positions they are, that we give them that leeway to make that determination?
You have to give them the leeway. And, you know, that knock and announce, sometimes that's a very short period of time. If they hear people scrambling around behind the door or they hear things that are just, that it give them concern. So you don't want to put too many tight binds on them.
Let me do a follow-up with that too, because one of the issues that many times that we in public office, when we're first sworn in, we're sworn in to uphold the Constitution of the United States, and the constituents that I have are certainly concerned about the Constitution. And in fact, even today, you mentioned the Second Amendment in your opening remarks. Ms. Laughlin mentioned the First Amendment. Mr. Scott mentioned the Fourth Amendment. I think in some time during the hearings, Mr. Conyers has actually talked about somewhere in the 14th Amendment. We've heard the issue with the good old boy roundup. What do you do in your agency to make sure that your officers know and understand the rights of the American people?
In their training in Georgia, when they first come on, there's a lot of time spent in terms of the constitutional rights, how you perform your duties, and making sure that you recognize and uphold those constitutional rights. They're reminded in their refresher training courses, anytime you have a major court case where somebody has made a mistake and caused a problem along those lines, we make sure that it's out there and it's shared with them. And so that's the way we do it. In terms of their practical application of our special response teams and things of that nature, all of those items are covered so that we are not violating the Constitution.
Is there disciplinary action at all taken, or is it on an individual basis if we uncover that in fact has not happened?
Well, there's disciplinary action taken if they violate those guidelines. It depends on the certain circumstance and exactly what happened. So you have to treat them as individual cases. And one of my concerns since coming to ATF and what my employees have told me is that they don't perceive as they sit out there in the field that there's equal justice in terms of penalty for somebody doing committing a violation and somebody of a higher authority committing violation. They don't get the same penalty. So I've set up a review panel that has to review every one of these cases that come in. And they review them faceless, and they review them on the actual facts and what have we done in the past and what is fair and like judgments. So that should be corrected within the next few. It's operational as of August 1.
And I appreciate that response. And at this time, I know that the gentlewoman from Texas, I'll yield the balance of my time.
The ranking member and the gentlewoman from Florida, and I'll try to focus on just one point, Mr. Noble, and I'll ask, put it in the form of a statement and then a question. And Mr. McGaw, you can add to the answer if you would, please, because you came from the Secret Service. Sometimes in the zealousness of defending our staff and those we work with and our departments, people assume bias. Mr. Noble, you have been a prosecutor, and my question would be, do you have any fear in prosecuting, if you were a prosecutor, or previously you may have had experience police abuse cases, or any fear in ferreting out any violations of the law that may come to your attention, along with a good old boy camp or any other aspects? Can you step aside from the personal feelings, the great tragedy, the lost, and be able to ferret out, to purge out, and if you stood in a prosecutorial posture, could you, in good conscience, prosecute those who are law enforcement officers who had violated the law? Mr. McGaw, you may answer it in the terms of how you would. I'd like Mr. Noble to answer first, and then Mr. McGaw, you might answer it in terms of how you would discipline, and would you be fearful of doing so because of your colleagues? Thank you.
I can tell you that as a prosecutor for 4+ years in Philadelphia, I never turned down a case. There were cases which I believed didn't merit prosecution, and I said so. I never indicted a person whom I didn't convict. I never took someone to trial or had a trial where the person wasn't convicted of something. I prosecuted public corruption cases, organized crime cases, drug trafficking cases. There wasn't a case I was afraid to prosecute despite the fact that I was threatened and attacked and spat upon. Now, it doesn't mean that I don't feel emotional when I see some of the things the victims go through, but I know how to investigate a case, and I know how to prosecute a case.
Mr. McGaw was answering the question as well.
Sure.
Thank you.
It was my policy at the Secret Service, it's my policy here, that if when the inspection team is out looking at an incident or a complaint, if they find anything that is a violation of law, I expect them to take it to the United States Attorney as if they would any other case and present it, not presenting it in any tone that they would want it declined, but presenting it based on the facts. And when they come back with the U.S. Attorney's opinion, then I have no problem moving forward with the prosecution. Absent of that, I have no problem, and I try to make sure, and I think my past will have shown that I take fair but forceful action in all employee matters.
Thank you. Thank you, Mrs. Thurman. Thank you, Mrs. Jackson-Lee. Mr. Noble, are you yet prepared to respond to Mr. Bryant's inquiries about this memorandum February 16, 1994, that you were looking into, or if
yes.
Not, we'll...
I am prepared, but I will qualify my answer that I'm not thinking as clearly now as I was several hours ago. So if I could amend it in writing, I would greatly appreciate it. If I can direct your attention to page D16,
We see an entry on page D16 at the 9:10 a.m. mark that says Hanaski calls the National Command Center in Washington, D.C. and informs the operation is a go. During that phone call, Mr. Hanaski did not say that Mr. Rodriguez had come out of the compound with any particular information. If you turn to page D17, you will see at the entry marked 9:55 a.m. It says NCC is notified by the TSTC command post, warrant executed, agents receiving gunfire. If you look at the document marked 12,953, the first, second, third full paragraph, that conversation captured in that paragraph reflects the phone call that occurred at 9:55 a.m. And these entries were entries that were generated based on telephone records, so they are correct as listed.
You may follow up to the extent of getting clarification, Mr. Bryan. I think that was part of the rules of the game at that time. In fact, you still had a minute left when Mr. Noble asked that you have that time. So go ahead.
Again, I understand it is late, but I'm still concerned about the telephone call that occurred prior to the raid. And that's unnumbered paragraph 4 on that document, 12953. It's apparently a call that Mr. Wozniacki did not make, because he's referenced early on. This is from some unidentified person.
That's correct.
And he made the call to indicate that Mr. Howell, Mr. Koresh, what he told Mr. Rodriguez. Now, I still do not see that reflected in your log.
No, sir. If you look at 9:55 a.m. entry, that is the phone call that's reflected in the third paragraph of this memorandum of interview.
Okay.
Now, I'm sorry.
That's the big paragraph. Sauter was asking. I believe, right?
Am I looking at the wrong?
No, you're looking at the right one. Both Mr. Bryan and Mr. Sauter ask you about that.
The third full paragraph.
Right.
Right. But look at the paragraph above there. This is chronological. It talks about approximately 9:10 to 9:15.
And what I'm telling you is I've talked to the agent who interviewed this person. The agent's name is Robert M. Gaddison. And the time sequence between the paragraph that begins with the blackout portion and then entered is not immediately following in time, like 9:16, what preceded the previous paragraph.
Yeah. Well, there still seems to be some confusion. Perhaps we can straighten that out.
Okay. I'm telling you that Mr. Vita has been interviewed. We read the report of Mr. Vita's interview, and it says that he received the phone call after the raid had begun. So that has been we've been able to confirm that this is what this paragraph is referring to with a blanked out agent's phone call to headquarters, that it happened afterwards. And what had happened is the agent who entered the command post made a call to Washington after Mr. Hanowski had already departed and flown towards the compound. The raid began, and during the phone conversation, they hear Kavanaugh repeatedly calling for the helicopters over the radio. So what I'm telling you is that paragraph occurred at the 9:55 Texas time phone call entry.
If just for last comment on clarification, Mr. Noble, and I know you're digesting this and you said it's late yourself, but in that third full paragraph, it would appear that the person who is receiving this call is saying that he's aware at that point that that Rodriguez, being the undercover person I referred to there, had been informed of Howell's comments, et cetera. And so, in other words, they'd learned about it at that point. That was not reflected as an entry at 9:55 in your log at the end of on that list. Now, whether that means anything or not, I don't know. I'm not disputing your word that that's what that call is, but I think you would agree with me that
absolutely.
Is
that you're clarifying or elucidating what additional language we could have included at the entry for 9:55. I simply wanted to make clear, and the clarification that you've made is worth noting. It took us a while to figure this out, so it's a very good point.
It was at 9:55, essentially, the first report came back to Washington that clarified that Rodriguez had made some report.
That's right, and the fact that that the raid had gone bad. That's correct, both of those details.
At the same time, at 9:55.
Correct.
All right. Are you satisfied, Mr. Bryant? Is that? All right. Thank you very much. Then,
Sorry about the delay.
Then, Mr. Barr, you're recognized for 5 minutes at this time.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Mr. McGaugh, one of the very serious problems that I see in this is the role of the early contacts with the media, and that is pre-raid on the 28th, and I know that's dealt with extensively in the ATF Treasury Department report, but I was a little bit disappointed in your written statements on page 10. You address the question of the media, but more in the context of the ability of the Bureau to respond accurately and effectively to the media. The problem that I see is not so much the ATF's ability to respond effectively and accurately to the media, but pre-raid leaks to the media. I think the lady this morning was a little bit disingenuous. I think in the context, as detailed in this report, of the days leading up to the raid, it was very clear that there was a great deal of information out there. Whether or not the media was tipped off by somebody in ATF or not, we'll probably never know, but I think it's very clear that when she made her call Saturday evening, whenever it was, that certainly didn't help maintain the secrecy of it, and I would hope that ATF would be coming up with some very clear and very strict guidelines on pre-operation contacts with the media, because I think very clearly, and I think Mr. Hartnett made this point very emphatically, that this may be one of those situations where perhaps if leaks had not occurred, maybe this tragedy would not have occurred.
May I make comment on that?
Yeah, just very briefly, please. Yes, you know how limited in
time
we are here.
The operations security officer that I told you we have working full-time now, that's going to be their responsibility. Each of these groups, like the press group, is rewriting those, and then we want to wait till that OPSEC person has a chance to approve them, and we all agree. But we are on that item. It's
okay,
very serious.
Because I know that was a problem that I saw with ATF when I was in the prosecutorial arena. Mr. Noble, following up on a line of questioning that Chairman Hyde and you, or a dialogue that you and he engaged in earlier with regard to the ATF shooting review, I'd like, Mr. Bush, there are a few documents here. You probably already do have them, but since I'm going to refer to them specifically, Mr. Bush will give you those. One is a memo dated September 17th, but it refers to a March 1, 1993 incident. Then there's the April 9 McNamara to you memo, and then there is the April 14th memo from McNamara to John Simpson. The first of these is the entry on March 1, 1993, and this is one I think the Chairman Hyde referred to. The ATF begins its shooting review, which is entirely appropriate, I believe. Immediately, it's apparent, according to this note, that the stories do not add up. And then comes the, I think, very, very strange entry concerning stopping the interviews and taking no more notes. Then we have the April 9th memo, which deals with press releases, and there I think that's somewhat different, and I think it's not entirely wrong to make very clear that discussions and statements that are released, both agencies need to be very careful so that in their public statements they don't say something that could prejudice an investigation or a prosecution. But then the April 14th memo is somewhat problematic again, in that it says very clearly the DOJ is directing that no further interviews or discussions with any participants who may be potential witnesses be undertaken. It very clearly states that they do not want to generate any additional Jenks, Brady or Giglio material. And then it goes on from there. We have had, as I presume you're aware, some discussions with other witnesses on two or if not all 3 days last week concerning whether or not this is indeed either standard or appropriate procedure. I don't think it's either in my experience as a United States attorney. And Mr. Johnston, the assistant U.S. attorney in Waco, when he was asked about these, he agreed with that it was not standard operating procedure. And I just wanted to clarify that. Do you think it is, in fact, standard operating procedure that once a shooting review has been initiated very properly where there's been a shooting, particularly one as serious as here, that it's appropriate or standard for the Department of Justice to explicitly state we don't want this to proceed forward because there might be, heaven forbid, exculpatory
evidence created, and there are to be no further interviews or discussions, and no notes are to be taken.
At no time during the investigation by the Treasury Department of the Waco tragedy did any Justice Department official tell me that I or my employees should not or ought not to disclose any Brady material to them or to anyone. So that is my understanding, based on personal conversations I had with the
This has to do with disclosing Brady material. That's not my question. This has to do with the generation of potential Brady, Giglio, or Jenks material, and the Department of Justice, through these memos, is directing that no further evidence be gathered in the shooting review. My question is not about disclosure within the executive branch, but is that sort of directive to those conducting a shooting review, which is a very serious incident, standard operating procedure, or indeed is it appropriate?
I believe it is quite appropriate for the Justice Department, when it's prosecuting very serious crimes as those with which the 11 defendants were accused of committing, to make certain that if there is a complementary investigation by another component, that that investigation not jeopardize the criminal investigation in a lawful manner. And what I'm saying, sir, is nothing in my experience at the Justice Department nor in my experience at the Treasury Department would lead me to believe that the Justice Department would ever want the Treasury Department not to disclose or uncover or reveal Brady material. I see a bright line distinction between Brady and Jenks.
You don't think that these memos, by their explicit terms, do precisely that?
I do not, sir. And I would tell you that we conducted over 500 interviews. The Texas Rangers conducted 80-plus interviews. At no time were we not permitted to interview anyone we wanted to interview, and the Justice Department was quite supportive of our investigation.
Mr. Barr, your time has expired. Mr. Schumer, you're recognized for 5 minutes.
Thank you, Mr. Noble. I know it's been a long day for you, but I think it's been a worthwhile day, because both with the previous panel and with this panel, the report that Treasury did holds up extremely well. In fact, the only real dissents we've heard from it are from people who were criticized in the report, the most outrageous of which was Mr. Hartnett, who talked about a cover-up, and yet, first, he didn't point out what was covered up. Second, his main criticism was that there were no explicit instructions from Treasury down to ATF, from the top levels of ATF down to the folks in the field to call off the raid if there were surprise. The irony of that, and I wish Hartnett were back here, I just didn't get a chance to question him after this, is that Hartnett himself could have made that explicit. So he's blaming the report for a cover-up, and yet at the time he could have said that. And so I don't consider his words very dispositive, particularly, and then when you look at the main critics of the report, there may have been a little fact left out here or not, but it's extremely comprehensive. It didn't talk about what an agent's favorite color was, but it had all the material facts in it, none of which were in dispute. And a few people here tried to bring out, well, it didn't have this, this, or this, but those are not material facts. The only people who disputed it in the long amounts of questioning we have had, the only witnesses who disputed what was in the report were people who were criticized in it, namely Sarabin, Hojnicki, and particularly Hartnett. And I have to say, I found Hartnett's performance dismal is a good word. I was going to use another D word, despicable, but maybe I wouldn't go that far. It was certainly dismal, and I find it sort of strange because you could see within him he wants to defend the agency, but I guess he felt so badly about his role and the fact that he was severely chastised that he wasn't. But the overall point I want to make is your report holds up real well. And I would say, for instance, by way of contrast, if the FBI had done what you did and went for outside review and was as comprehensive at Ruby Ridge, it would be in a lot better shape than it is today. I'd like to just go back and reiterate Mr. Barr's point. He keeps bringing this up, and I don't agree with him, and I think we've made it clear all along. Just to reiterate, is it usual procedure, it doesn't happen every time, but it happens rather frequently, that to not jeopardize an ongoing criminal prosecution, justice will tell an agency, Treasury, ATF, they've done it in the Whitewater hearings a few times, the prosecutor has, to not do certain things because it might jeopardize the criminal case, which is paramount. Is that standard procedure? Have you heard of it many times?
I would say it's not only standard procedure, but if you think about what happened here, here you had an agency that was conducting a post-shooting review and was being dishonest with the results of the review. And you have justice not saying stop the review, but saying let's shift it from ATF to the Texas Rangers.
Right.
So we just had to go from party A to party B.
I can imagine the critics, if ATF were continued, when on the issue of the guns and whether they were made into automatic guns, their whole beef is that there was an ATF agent, a Treasury agent, who looked at the guns first. You know, they want it each way. On the one hand, to have the agency involved investigating immediately thereafter is very bad, can lead to cover-up or whatever. And on the other hand, when an impartial agency comes in or a different agency comes in, that is very bad, too. You can't win with some of the critics, I suppose, Mr. Noble, but you're used to that. Mr. McGaul, let me just ask you, with your years of experience in both the Secret Service and now in ATF, again, is it in any way unusual, a deviation from the norm, and apart from the, being apart from the standard operating procedure for justice to come in and say, please, halt your preliminary investigation. We don't want to jeopardize the criminal investigation. We're going to do it.
Not at all.
Not at all. Okay. I'm not going to get any further into my views of why that point is being pushed. And let me ask you another question here. Mr. Noble, we've heard from members on both sides of the aisle, and I believe this. I believe this of many of my colleagues on both sides of the aisle, that we want to use these hearings to strengthen federal law enforcement. And I think they mean, although maybe they wouldn't say it explicitly, to strengthen ATF. I certainly believe that. To strengthen it, not to tear it down. And they want the hearings to strengthen the public image of federal law enforcement, not tarnish it. From your perspective, could you tell us what you think Congress can do from here to be constructive rather than destructive to law enforcement agencies that you represent here? I'd like to ask Mr. Noble and Mr. McGaw to answer that question.
The first thing Congress can do is that when an agency like the Department of the Treasury and a bureau like ATF engages in a kind of self-examination that produced this 500-page, very thoughtful, very comprehensive report, and where no one other than people criticized, challenge it in it, the core accuracies it contains, that we can get a pat on the back instead of having our parents listen on television or see on television where someone says there was a cover-up, or I engaged in a cover-up, or the department engaged in a cover-up without showing what fact was missing or not disclosed.
Mr. McGaw, you get that pat on the back from most of us. There are a few people who've been irresponsible with the word cover-up, but you get that pat on the back from most of us, Democrats and Republicans, and from the majority of the American people. Mr. McGaw?
Well, as I said before, I welcome the oversight. I think it's needed. I'm a law enforcement person for 34 years. I look at things like a law enforcement officer does. I need it to be looked at by a former United States attorney, as many of you are. And also, it's such a controversial issue that we deal with. You have to understand what the problems are and what we're trying to do in order to give us the support we need in terms of budget and other things when there's a huge lobby out there that will be trying to get you to do other things. So I welcome it. And it will make us a much better organization. This hearing here will make all of law enforcement, local, state, county, and federal, better.
Thank you, Mr. Schumer. Your time has expired. Mr. Shadegg, you're recognized for 5 minutes.
Mr. Chairman, may I at some point?
Who's asking here? Oh, Mr. Noble. I'm sorry.
I'm sorry.
Looking so busy at my members, I wasn't looking at the witness.
At some point, I would just like to answer the question of Mr. either Souter or Souter. With regard to this document.
You may do that now before Mr. May
I do that?
Shadegg goes ahead, please.
Mr. Is it Souter or Souter?
I believe it's Souter.
Souter correctly pointed out that
the document marked 19,385 included that ATF did not possess the expertise or the negotiators necessary for a siege, and that was a factor that ought to have been included in the list of reasons that were articulated on pages 134 to 142, explaining why ATF or how ATF did not fully exhaust other options. So I just want to point for the record that's a fair criticism, and Mr. Souter is correct.
In other words, what you're saying is that the negotiator, that they didn't have either the negotiators or the expertise to do a siege, and that was not...
That they didn't have the...
That's what that comment read.
That they did not have possessed the expertise or the negotiators necessary for a siege, that they, it goes on further,
right,
anticipated would last several months.
Right.
Yes, sir.
Thank you.
Chairman, I have unanimous consent request.
You may state it.
The Treasury has put together a bunch of documents. They all come from the requested documents that show that there was, that at least they believe there was a significant drug. And that these documents be put in the record.
There's a reservation of the right to object over here.
It mystifies me that throughout these hearings, whenever we request documents, we don't get them for days or weeks. Whenever we request weapons, we don't get them for days or weeks. And then suddenly, the minority can produce them. I just find it absolutely baffling that that happens over and over and over and over again. And now it's happening one more time. I'd like to make a conditional request. We started this hearing with the testimony of the author of the book, who said that there are hundreds of reports prepared by the Texas Rangers that he can't get access to, that he has to file suit to. It seems to me that Mr. Schumer has some miracle power to get anything he wants.
Hey, if you're nice, I may tell you what it is.
I'd love to have these documents come in, but could we condition it upon him also getting the Texas Rangers reports in so the American people can see those?
Well, listen, if you want to make an arrangement and together we'll make a whole bunch of joint requests that will then be automatically honored by the chairman.
I haven't seen you fail yet.
Can I just...
Would someone yield on your reservation? Would someone yield the chairman?
I will yield. The documents have already been provided to the committees. So these are documents that you already possess.
And if the gentleman would yield just for a minute... These are all documents that came in the large number that were sent over, and I had asked the folks to put them together. They did, but only now. I would have rather, believe me, if I had my druthers, I would have liked these documents to be available when we had the military panel.
Well, use your index.
I was going to get a copy of the index because we got 48,000 pieces of paper index, which I think is absolutely irresponsible in the way that this thing has been set up, and it's wrong, and you know it, Chuck.
Well, now, hold on. On the reservation that Mr. Shattuck has, would he yield to me, please, in the regular order here? I would like to make the observation not to just simply concur in what Mr. Zeloff just said, because the failure to get the cooperation of the Treasury Department to provide us with an index has been a very difficult problem. That's why we don't know what all these documents are. It takes hours to try to figure out what one of these numbers is. You're reading it over, and you wonder what the heck it is. And I'm just wondering if, on your reservation, Mr. Noble might assure us that even though it might not be as timely for us as we would have preferred it to be, that somebody be assigned to provide us at as early a date as possible at Treasury an index to the documents that have been sent down here, because it is very difficult. We can pick them up, and then we're out here working with you. And while we don't expect in the future to have more opportunities to ask questions necessarily, and we certainly want to protract the hearings, we are going to be writing a report. And it would certainly be nice to be able to have our staff be given an index so that we could intelligently look at what you have sent over here. Would you mind asking that?
If you'd only asked me, I would have provided it gladly. I will provide it.
Can we ask you now?
I will provide it.
Thank you.
And I would just renew my unanimous consent request, making it, I just asked for these. It took a few days to get them, and they weren't delivered. Someone mentioned, I don't remember if it's Mr. Zeloff, Mr. McCollum, or Mr. Shattuck, that the request wasn't timely. This one isn't timely either for my best purposes. I wish I had had it a few days ago.
Continuing my right to object, will Mr. Schumer join me in a letter to the Texas Rangers saying that it is important to the people of America that we be able to see those reports as this investigation was conducted by Texas Rangers?
Sure, I'd like to. Will you join me in a letter to the Texas Rangers asking that all the guns that were found in the compound be made available? That's
my
been blocked by the majority, will you?
My understanding is that you've already made it clear
it's
you can produce those here.
It's been blocked by the majority, sir.
Well, if you'll yield on your reservation over here, we did not...
I'll yield.
We
Yeah, these documents are here. I don't know about the Texas Rangers documents, but these documents that we're talking about here are here. We did not wish to see a roadshow up here of guns at this late hour when we didn't have time to examine.
I didn't have the Texas Ranger documents, but...
Yes. Hold on. We still have Mr. Shattig on a reservation. If somebody wants time, they got to ask him to yield or they got to reserve the right to...
Would the gentleman yield?
I'll withdraw my objection.
The objection's been withdrawn. Unanimous consent requested without objection.
Yeah,
it is
point
so ordered.
Of clarification. First, as I understand it, you have the Texas Ranger documents. Second, I would welcome the opportunity to have a joint letter, do a joint letter with Mr. Shattuck with both requests. Is he willing to do that? And I yield to him to answer.
Mr. That's
it's always good that we should join you in getting your
Mr.
stuff,
Schumer,
but you never join us in getting our stuff.
That's not an order at this point in time. You can certainly ask him at some point down the road. Mr. Shattuck, you're recognized for your 5 minutes.
Mr. Chairman, just one other question. Are we down the road yet?
It's not an order now. Mr. Shattuck is being recognized for his 5 minutes.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I appreciate it very much. It's not probably too surprising that Mr. Schumer and I differ on some points. Perhaps if he'd been here more of the day, he would not make such a bold statement as that all of the material facts are revealed in the report.
First of all, wait a second, Mr. Chairman. Point of personal privilege.
You made that...
Point of personal privilege, Mr. Chairman.
You may make the point.
Fine. The point is, first, I was here for all but 1 hour. I don't know if Mr. Shattuck was, but that kind of ad hominem... unrelated to the issue attack, I would match my knowledge of what happened and what the witnesses said to Mr. Shattuck's any day of the week.
Right,
and we don't need that kind of poison further contaminating the hearings.
Well,
and I yield back.
Mr. Schumer, you made your point of personal privilege, but Mr. Shattuck has a right to make his observation. So, Mr. Shattuck,
thank you,
have
Mr. Chairman.
Full 5 minutes.
As someone who spent 8 years of my life in law enforcement, with the Arizona Attorney General's office, and whose father was a deputy sheriff, and who believes deeply in their mission, I think what we're about today is extremely important. I think it is important to review incidents of this type to try to assure that they don't go again, that they never occur again. Mr. Noble, I commend you for starting the process which led to this report, and I commend you for the thoroughness of the report. And if what you are seeking is an attaboy, I'm glad to give you one. However, if you think that that should be the end of it, that it should never have to be discussed in a hearing such as this or aired, I think you are mistaken. In your opening statement, you say, in this report, Treasury presented the full facts to the American people. You go on to say, therefore, I look forward in the report of these subcommittees to a resounding affirmation of the Treasury report. Well, I'm willing to give you an affirmation that I'm glad you started the process, but I think you ought to be willing to objectively review it. Let's start with the document we just discussed, the document that details these telephone calls. You testified in response to questioning by Mr. Shabbat that, in fact, no one in Washington knew that the intelligence agents had discovered that Mr. Howell was aware the ATF was coming. In point of fact, this document...
I said before the raid.
Well, that's not what you said. That's not what I heard.
The record will verify what I said. I said before the raid went bad that Mr. Rodriguez had come out of the compound saying that Koresh was expecting
You would
ATF.
Agree with me that this document establishes that they knew at least contemporaneously with the raid, would you not?
That they knew at least contemporaneously with the raid.
Your own log says that they received a phone call. You said that's this memo. This memo clearly says that Howell knows the ATF is coming.
The memo does not clearly say that. What the memo says is it says that the person whose name's blacked out contacted Washington at 9:55 a.m. Texas time to report what he'd been told.
No, it doesn't. It says Vita asked why the teams were going in early and the agent informed him of Howell's comments to undercover.
That's right. And what it doesn't say, sir, with all due respect, what it doesn't say is the precise time that that particular statement was made. Well, the log says 9:55 a.m.
Well, are you
all
questioning
I'm
the time?
All I said for the record is my testimony, the best of my knowledge, as honest as I can be, is that ATF headquarters was not told about the contents of Mr. Rodriguez's statement prior to the raids going forward. That's the best of my knowledge.
And this memo is not revealed in your report, and the fact that ATF knew is not.
But the information is consistent.
If I could continue. Within the first 2 days of this hearing, we discovered that Mr. Aguilera had been offered a chance to go in and look at the weapons by Mr. Koresh. He did not take that offer up. Although that conversation is discussed at page 26 of your report in the discussion of Mr. McMahon, the fact that he did not, that he was offered the chance by Koresh to go into the compound and look at the weapons, and the fact that he declined that is not in the report. We also learned from Mr. Aguilera that he told Mr. Saraband of this offer. He'd been offered a chance to go in. Although there's a discussion of the conversation with Mr. McMahon, once again, the fact that he reported this to Saraband, that he had been offered the chance to go in and see the premises and see the weapons, is not in the report. We learned that Mr. Hartcheck and Mr. Saraband, in discussing the decision to go forward with the dynamic raid, discussed the fact that Aguilera had been offered the chance to go in and look at the building, and they rejected that and decided not to ever take up Koresh on that offer. Again, that is not in the report. And we learned in the course of these hearings that there are a number of occasions when Mr. Koresh was off of the premises that are not disclosed in the report. I think when you tell the American people that the full facts are presented and you look for a resounding affirmation and you find that kind of series of errors, it seems to me that the American people have a right to look beyond the language of the report. I commend you for starting it, but I think it is important that the American people have the right through the oversight process to go in behind it and to look. I just want to make a couple more points.
Will I be able to remember all of them?
I don't know. But it's my nickel, just like it was Mr. Schumer's.
So you're going to ask me 20 questions, and I'm going to try to remember 20 questions, or can I at least do it in part?
You seem to have been doing quite well all afternoon. None of those were questions in any event. I think they were mostly my opinion. There is a statement that you made in your opening statement where you said, point blank, Mr. Hordachek and Mr. Saraband were fired, and you said, because they refused to give up their guns and badges and agree to stop enforcing the law. That was a direct quote from you in your statement. That conflicts with your written statement, and yet I listened carefully to what you said in the hearing. I want to know what proof you have, and here's a question you can answer or attempt to answer. What proof do you have to give these committees that, in fact, the reason they were fired was because they refused to give up their guns and refused to continue enforcing the law?
I'm going to start with the last first, if you don't mind, and try to get to the others. The point I was making in my oral remarks, and to the extent they are different from my written remarks, is that I was working most recently on my oral remarks, and I believe I made it clear to the chairman. So I apologize for the inconsistencies, but I promise to reconcile them right now to the extent that I can. There were a number of reasons why Mr. Saraband and Mr. Hanowski were fired. It's my recollection of the events, and if my recollection is not 100% accurate, please forgive me at this point, but I will follow it up and clarify the written record if you don't mind, that they had a chance during the settlement discussions to agree to certain conditions, including giving up their gun, their badges, their rank, and the right to enforce federal criminal law, and that they did not agree to that. So I believe, and again, I will let the lawyers clarify the record. This is just based on my recollection. I believe that because they didn't agree to those conditions, and since those conditions were the most essential conditions, may I continue to answer even though the red
sure.
light's on?
The reason you gave is not cited in either of the papers dismissing them or in the settlement agreements when they're rehired, is it?
I'm just telling you of what my understanding was of the final settlement package and whether or not those conditions were offered previous to the final settlement package. I may be wrong on it, but let me just tell you what was most important to me. In the report on pages 182 to 183, we say that any individual whose judgment or integrity cannot be trusted by those who must rely on those qualities must be removed from a position of discretionary authority. So that's all the report wanted to say with regard to that. I'll ask the lawyers to amend my statement if my recollection doesn't reflect reality. With regard to the reports not mentioning the number of times Mr. Koresh left the compound, I take issue with you. I can't remember the footnote or the page, but again, I will cite that later. I cited it earlier during this hearing. With regard to your overarching comment about what I expected from these hearings, I will tell you what I expected. I endorse your right to have hearings. I embrace it. But what I expected to happen was that this document, a very comprehensive document that you've made better with the points that weren't included that you believe ought to have been included, when Chief Heineman says we included too much, it's too long as it was, that people would write the reports differently, perhaps. If you were authoring it, you might write it differently. You might have included certain facts that I excluded. There are thousands and thousands and thousands of pages of memoranda of interview that form the basis for this report. I expected this Congress to closely scrutinize it, assuming that it was generated in good faith, assuming that it was not a product that was designed to cover up, and that if you found details that you thought should be included, you would say, Mr. Noble, Director McGaw, whoever generates a report again, make sure that when you have a log, you include this fact. Make sure when you have a footnote, you don't put it in this place. Make sure that you do A, B, C, or D, A, B, C, or D, that you would give us constructive feedback, not that we would be defending the integrity of a report that no one has challenged but those criticized in it, sir. Thank you.
Well, at no time have I challenged the integrity of the report. I do think there are things that should be brought out. One last point I want to make. In your opening statement, and it shocked me, and I hope it's incorrect and you'll disavow it now.
Is the red light
said,
on?
rather not answer?
It is, and Mr. Shadi, your time really has expired. Make your point and we're going on.
He's that worried about this question. I thought it was a softball.
Make it and we're going to...
You said, and I quote, I do not believe the people of America need their faith in federal law enforcement restored. Those were your words. I assume you didn't mean them, because it is absolutely clear to me and the people I talk to in day-to-day life that the people of America do need their faith restored, and that that's why you initiated the report, and that's why we're conducting these hearings, that we've got to, if we were to have an ordered society where people obey the laws and respect law enforcement officers and don't meet them with gunfire, we've got to restore the faith of the American citizens in their law enforcement.
I struggled with that sentence for quite some time.
And again, it conflicts with your written report. Your written opening statement essentially applauds the hearing.
No,
and says
the oral statement didn't take issue with the appropriateness of a hearing designed to help law enforcement officers avoid tragedies like Waco. There's no difference in the oral and written in that regard. But with regard to your comment about the American public, I thought about that sentence quite a bit. And especially with the good old boys roundup and some other unfortunate things that have occurred just as of late, I just hope, I guess in my heart, I would rather believe that the vast majority of Americans have confidence in their federal law enforcement officers and prosecutors, because I happen to believe the very vast majority of federal law enforcement officers and prosecutors are good people, are hardworking people, risk their lives, are protecting you and me and everyone else. So maybe I shouldn't have used that sentence, because someone could take issue with it right now in light of some comments that I believe are episodic and not systemic. So I take your point. Well,
I share your
now
confidence.
I know the red light is out now.
I share your confidence in the law enforcement officers of America. But I plead that we do have to restore faith.
Well, I thank you, Mr. Shattuck. We have let you go a little longer. I think the comments Mr. Noble was making were a very good way to close these hearings, which I even think the minority concludes are true. But on the other hand, we've got another full day tomorrow to go through before we recess.
I ask a point of personal privilege, if that is permitted from a witness?
The personal privilege from a witness is always taken into account.
Chairman Jelliffe led Mr. Hartnett down the road on the question of a cover-up, giving him a chance to say whether or not there was a cover-up or wasn't a cover-up. I would ask this committee that whatever it decides about a cover-up or not, about there being a cover-up or not being a cover-up, that if it concludes that there was a cover-up, that it focuses on me and not the many individuals who dedicated their time and efforts to generating a comprehensive report.
Let me respond to that, Mr. Zeloff, if I can, because you didn't do that, so you can too. Yeah, you may, but let me say to you that, as I recollect it, because the cover-up word was first used in response to a question that had been asked by Ms. Jackson Lee, and that I then elicited a comment from Mr. Hartnett on the very first time he appeared, not today. And during his answering the questions I asked him the other day, he said after it was all said and done that the word cover-up was probably not appropriate. He didn't mean that. What he meant, as I understood it, and he meant it again today, is that he felt that when you and that the rest of that 60-minute interview said with regard to the element of surprise and some other things, that the ATF officers were directed not to proceed with a raid without surprise, that and that the spin came down that way, that somehow you were cutting the cord between the ATF agents and yourself.
Today
and
he expressly said, I watched it. I watched it in shock. My mother called me up afterwards. So there's no doubt in my mind what he said today. And all I'm asking is after the evidence is settled, if you conclude that there was a cover-up, which I don't think you will, that you pointed on me and not the people who dedicated their lives to this report.
If I could just mention, and we really, it's a good point to bring out the president's criticism as well. And we don't like what we think is unfair, irresponsible comments. And really what we're doing is trying, we have all the faith and the trust of those wonderful law enforcement people who risk their lives 24 hours a day, 7 days a week. What we're trying to do, and I think when you and others say that, hey, this blue book is a Bible, man, don't question it, it's perfect. Well, we have oversight responsibility and we have a right to ask the questions, and you who investigate yourselves may do a perfect job. But I think that there is some evidence that it brought out here that some things that may have been missed. And I think we're all really trying to do the same thing here. And I think at the end here, we will have credibility. And I don't think anybody is going out after to try to, I mean, go after you or go after anybody else for that matter. We're just trying to get at the truth.
Well, I think, Mr. Conyers.
Might I just thank you as the ranking member on the Democratic side. I want to thank you for a very long day's hearing. I think you've conducted it very well. And I especially want to say that these two witnesses have been here off and on since 3:30, answering questions from 32 members of two different committees. They've been before this committee longer than any other witnesses here. And I think that we should recognize the incredible stamina and ability to respond as best they can. I noticed that the Undersecretary has committed himself to a number of further details in writing, which will be submitted to the committees, and I thank them very, very much for
that. Well, Mr. Conyers, we do thank them for that. I'd just like to take one note. While they've been here a long time, and they deserve whatever for that, I don't think they've been here longer than some others. We've had some pretty long times and breaks. They've lasted quite a long time so far already. And speaking of that, we're going to have to announce our schedule here. I will in a moment. I want to announce the schedule for tomorrow, then I'll let you have a moment, Mr. Scott, but not for much. Not for much discussion, let's put it that way. Just a little tiny bit. Well, take it right now.
Mr. Chairman, early today I asked Mr. Noble to respond to a question to review some material and respond. I think he has subsequently responded.
He's already done
and therefore that will not be necessary.
Thank you. All right, at night. If it is nothing more than the type of thing Mr. Scott did, Ms. Jackson Lee.
Mr. Chairman, because you elicited my name on information that I queried one of the witnesses regarding the cover-up, let me thank you for clarifying. I don't know how much further we'll go on this issue, but I hope that we can clarify or at least put on the record, however comments might have been made out of emotion or whatever else, whether you take the brunt of it, Mr. Noble, that we all are thinking that there is not or has not been a cover-up. I think that was the clarification that was being made.
Well, I don't think we're going to take any votes, Ms. Jackson Lee. But the bottom line of this, we're going to ask you a report later. We don't need to get into discussion of this or interpret what the witnesses had to say their intended. The record really speaks for itself. I was simply making a point to Mr. Noble in response to his point of personal privilege, as did Mr. Zeloff, of how all of this language got started. There still was a obvious problem and disagreement between quite a number of the witnesses, including Mr. Hartnett, over certain aspects of what they thought was right or wrong. We know that's on the record. We've had a full discussion about it.
Quite a number, I agree.
And so consequently, we're at that stage where we're not going to do any good to rehash that. The record will...
The other side had three.
Well, Mr. Mike, we're not here to make a lot of points now.
No, it's not another point, but I did not complete a number of very serious questions I have relating to personnel and civil service matters, hiring,
rehiring. Would you like to submit some questions for the record?
I will submit that, and I'm announcing today that in September or October, if I do not get sufficient answers to those personnel questions and civil service questions, there will be hearings on this subject.
Well,
thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Micah. For tomorrow on 9:30 a.m. start in this committee room, we'll have a break in the afternoon for a briefing. I'm not exactly sure what time it will occur, sometime late in the afternoon. We will go until panel C is finished, which will probably be very late tomorrow evening. On Wednesday, we're going to have a 9 a.m. start. I want everybody to be aware of that because we're going to have to take a break shortly before 11 o'clock for a joint session. But we want to get started. We've got a long day of hearings. We'll resume approximately 12:30 that day. And on Thursday, because of the Oversight Reform and Oversight Committee's hearings that they have to have, which we already knew about, we will not have a day of these hearings. That means we will go on Friday and Monday, according to the schedule, to complete our 8-day session. You may ask a question, Mr. Schumer.
Mr. Chairman, first, I was going to ask it of Mr. Shattuck, but he's gone already, so I will ask you. Is it possible, and I've talked this over with a number of people in the minority, since Monday is a day in which we don't have votes, and I don't need an answer now, then instead of going Monday, we go Tuesday when we do have votes and all have to be here. We're going to all be here Friday when there are no votes on the floor, but...
We want to accommodate to a large extent, but right now the chairs, both chairs, I think, are inclined to suggest that you be prepared for Monday because there are reasons from the scheduling standpoint of the committees and so forth that is highly improbable that this will get changed until Tuesday.
If the scheduling issues change, I just ask both chairs to consider
it. I understand that. Understood
it
very well. This hearing is in recess till tomorrow.
In just a moment, the fifth day of testimony on events at Waco, Texas. Jack Zimmerman, who was David Koresh's attorney, is one of the witnesses. The C-SPAN school bus is in Washington, D.C. this month. See the bus each morning on C-SPAN's Washington Journal. Also this summer, we look back at